This hearing will come to order, please. If members could have their seats. Call this hearing to order. Apologize, we're running about 10 minutes late here, but we will make up the time in substance and do good work. Good afternoon. Welcome to today's joint hearing to consider Proposition 25, which is titled Changes Legislative Vote Requirement to Pass Budget and Budget-Related Legislation from Two-Thirds to a Simple Majority. It retains the two-thirds vote requirement for taxes. Upon the hearing conclusion of this Prop 25 discussion, we will receive a brief update from the Comptroller's Office with regard to our cash position. This is a hearing that we're doing. It's required by California Election Code Section 9034. And as with other hearings on propositions, state resources cannot be used to either support or oppose the proposition. So please be aware this will not be a forum for members to really discuss their own personal views. Obviously, as you ask questions and you can talk about your views, but the purpose is really to get the facts out about these propositions and to get the witnesses to present their sides. But obviously, it's an appropriate time to ask the proponents and opponents questions about it. I do want to make a few observations before we get started about Prop 25 to potentially help frame this debate, and I hope both the proponents and opponents will consider some of these things. Just want to note that I have some concerns about how a majority vote budget impacts me as budget chair in this budget committee for a number of reasons, because one of the things that's presumed in it is that we get all the responsibility for crafting a budget, but in some ways not all of the authority for really doing everything that's needed to make an effective budget in terms of revenues. And whether or not that means that this budget committee will have the tools it needs in future years to be able to balance the budget appropriately. So I want to hear more about why this proposition stops short at allowing us to raise revenue but not control all aspects of the budget as an interesting question to be dealt with. You know, I sort of understand the political appeal of two-thirds, you know, of why we have it, although as someone who believes in democracy with small d, I don't personally like anything that's a supermajority, but I think people often think that two-thirds means more consensus. At least in my experience, it hasn't really been that way. Oftentimes, as budget chair, we've seen that a lot of times this two-thirds means that a 54 budget vote budget means there has to be more concessions made. As we try to piece together this budget, one of the big stumbling blocks we face is over $2 billion in new corporate tax cuts, including net operating loss carryback provisions, single sales factor, and others, which were all concessions that were part of a previous budget, things that we need to consider. I mean, there are oftentimes things that get put into a budget that really have nothing to do with budgeting, for example, the open primary issue that was inserted. So the question really is in terms of will lowering the threshold from 54 to a majority prevent some of this sort of leveraging of the budget for non-budgetary matters? I think that's an important question to deal with. Finally, I want to say something about my concerns with the provisions with regard to withholding legislative salaries. Certainly, I understand the politics of that situation, and these days with the legislature in such low esteem, anything punitive tends to, on legislators, tends to improve its it tends to improve its viability at the polling place. However, this concern about attaching individual personal a financial stake in budgetary decisions also has some policy implications that are worth looking into, because will that taint decisions that we make as legislators, regardless of what the intent of those decisions are and regardless of whether people ignore their personal financial interest, will just having that financial interest create some sort of a problem? These are some of the questions. I'd like to, before we get started, ask the Senate Chair, Denise Duchenne, who has really just been a great partner with me on the conference committee, and I have tremendous respect for her, and ask her if she'd like to add some opening comments before we get started, and then I'll also ask the vice chairs.
Thank you. You got the red on. There you go. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and I just appreciate that the Assembly is holding this hearing. Just for those who may be watching, these are required that we hold hearings on all proposed election year initiatives, and we appreciate that the Assembly did this one. We had a couple of other hearings on other propositions yesterday in both houses, I think, and I think it's important that folks do pay attention to the pluses, minuses, the LAO analysis that we get on these. This one in particular has been around before, and I know I share some of the concerns expressed by the chairman, and I've tried for years to get people to say it should be 55% for both and to do it differently, and I've also had major concerns about tying anybody's salary to what is a conscience vote and a vote, you know, that is really designed for the good of the public. But when the legislature doesn't get to craft the bill, that's what happens. I think initiatives are, you know, by definition difficult because of that. Tend to use focus groups rather than policy as the basis. But nonetheless, I think it is an important discussion for us to think about this question of democracy. And certainly sitting here on the 80th day since the budget should have been passed or so, it would seem to me certainly we've shown that there could have been a majority vote budget at some point in the past, much closer to July 1st. And it would be saving a lot of people right now who are suffering, child care recipients, businesses that are closing down, Cal Grant students that are thinking about whether they can stay in college, all of those. The delays in budgets have become an ongoing and very desperate situation. So we'll look forward to hearing from folks. I apologize, I probably will have to leave before everybody's had a chance to testify, but other members of the Senate are here, and we'll be able to stay somewhat longer. So thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And Vice Chair, Mr. Nielsen, would you like some opening comments?
If I may, it is rather difficult to start this without just a little bit of debate. And fundamental question is, what will this really accomplish in the long term? Will it ensure timely budgets? Maybe. I would not argue that it would guarantee them. But a more important question, will it ensure reasonable, responsible budgets? Questions need to be examined in depth today as, you know, what do these provisions really mean? There's a great deal of ambiguity, would be subject to future interpretation by legislatures and the courts, which is of greatest concern to me. I have some questions that I want to examine. Does this two-thirds vote for taxes really mean that? Or are there a lot of loopholes in here that would do such? And that should be a particular concern because a majority vote does not invite restraint in spending. It invites more spending. Even Republicans may be tempted to pack this budget, and there could be some pressures even if the two-thirds vote is a real two-thirds vote requirement. So this is a very important hearing required constitutionally, and Mr. Chairman and Madam Vice Chair, I do appreciate you convening it, giving us this opportunity to hopefully get the citizens of California a lot more hard evidence of what this really will mean in the long run. And that is the impact on the citizens.
Thank you, Mr. Nielsen. The Senate Vice Chair is not here, but Mr. Harmer, would you like to, in his place, make some comments? Okay, then. So I'd like to call up Mr. Mac Taylor, Legislative Analyst Office, Legislative Analyst, to come up and provide an overview on Proposition 25. We're going to have members make statements during question and answers, and unless it's super pressing, I'd like to move on to the witness. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members. Proposition 25 is a short measure and I think relatively straightforward, so I'm not going to spend a lot of your time. I'll let you get on to the proponents and opponents. There are two key constitutional requirements currently in the state law that lead to two-thirds votes on the budget. One is that to pass a general fund appropriation, you need a two-thirds vote. Many people think that there's a requirement that the budget have a two-thirds vote. That's only the case because it includes general fund appropriations. There's one very important exception to that rule, that's appropriations from the general fund for public education, public schools. The second two-thirds vote that you need in order to really make a budget effective is you have to. It has to take effect immediately. That requires an urgency vote, which the Constitution requires be done by a two-thirds vote. So what this measure does, in effect, allowing you to pass a budget by a majority vote, is two things. It includes within the exceptions to that two-thirds vote on a general fund appropriation, appropriations, the budget bill, and for bills providing for appropriations related to the budget bill. And I'll get back to that in just a second. These bills providing for appropriations related to the budget bill would have to be specified, presumably listed in the budget bill itself. So there's some control over what's included within this majority vote. So the measure also specifies that these two types of bills could take effect immediately. So there's where you get, in effect, the majority vote. The measure also has what the chair referred to as this provision: when the budget goes past June 15th, your current constitutional deadline to pass a budget, it legislators would forfeit their salary, their compensation, living expenses, reimbursement for travel until a budget was presented to the governor. So I think an important distinction is that it doesn't mean that a budget is enacted. It just means until you pass a budget to the governor. Now, just a couple of key issues. First of all, on this, these bills that are provide appropriations that are related to the budget bill, we've assumed that what the proponents were really talking about were what we call trailer bills. These are bills that are passed that have to implement changes to law, typically in order to effectuate the budget bill, either to achieve savings by providing for reductions in benefits that we provide or benefits to recipients. But that's not exactly the language that the proponents have used. And so I think there's a lot of overlap, because many trailer bills that you do approve include appropriations. So it would cover those. However, you have trailer bills that do not include appropriations. And in those cases, you would either, one, continue to have a two-thirds vote on those measures, two, pass them effective January 1, like other bills, which could then be done on a majority vote, or three, you could include in all trailer bills an appropriation that was related to the subject matter at hand in order to have them included as budget bills covered by the measure. So it could change in some ways your behavior in dealing with budget bills that are related to the budget. The second issue that I want to raise is one that the chair also mentioned, and this is, does it deal with vote increases? Now, the measure itself has in its intent language a fairly clear statement that it does not in any way change the current requirement under Prop 13 that the state tax increases have to be passed with a two-thirds vote. There was the Attorney General included this statement that you saw, and I think the chair read about it retains the two-thirds requirement for taxes. That was challenged by opponents. They won at the Superior Court level. At the appellate court level, they referred back to and allowed the original language to stand. The court was fairly strong and definitive in the language of the decision. They said, we find nothing in the substantive provisions of Prop 25 that it would allow the legislature to circumvent the existing constitutional requirement of a two-thirds vote to raise taxes. Now, that's an unpublished opinion, so I'm not sure it has precedential value. However, if you take the statement in the purpose of the measure, the title, the way we've characterized it, I think there's at least a fairly large threshold that someone who would question that would have to overcome, but it would have to be a legal challenge, and I'm sure that proponents and opponents can speak to that. Just very quickly, so what would be the effect of this fiscally if it passed? It was impossible for us to kind of easily summarize what might happen. Clearly, it could change significantly or dramatically the dynamics in this building when a budget's being considered, and it would depend largely upon the makeups of the two houses and who's sitting in the governor's office. Clearly, you can imagine some cases where it might not have much effect at all. If you have a governor who's of the same party as the minority party and they're in sync, having this majority vote would just mean you could pass a budget, but it wouldn't be signed, and you would still have to go through what essentially maybe you're going through right now. You can also imagine other cases where it would be very different from the current situation. By only requiring a majority vote, I think it's fair to say that there are many situations where it will be easier to pass a budget. Now, what does that mean for the makeup of the budget? If you agree or concur in the thinking that, well, it doesn't apply to tax increases, you could say, well, you're kind of dealing with the same pie that you already have of revenues, and all you're talking about is how do you divvy them up. In a case where you're having to make cuts, it may just be that this vote, majority vote, will change the makeup of the reductions that you're forced to make. However, I think it is more than that. Clearly, many of our solutions have involved non-tax revenues, whether it's fees, whether it's sale of state assets, revenue accelerations, compliance-related measures. You do pass a lot of things that are non-tax revenues. So I don't think you can just view the pie, the amount of revenues you have to play with, is unchanging. But clearly, without the tax increases, if that's off the table, that provides about 95% of your revenues. So that portion of it would not be changed. You would be essentially talking about different allocations of the reductions or different allocations of how you spend that money. So again, it is very difficult for me to easily summarize what could happen, and I think you can probably appreciate that more than most. There is the final point of small fiscal effect should the budget run late. We estimated that for every day past the June 15th, you would save about $50,000. Again, that can be fairly easily circumvented by just passing some budget by June 15th, even if it's not signed by the governor. With that, I'd be happy to answer any questions, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Actually, before we have questions, we have 23 members here. And just to keep things moving, what I'd like to do is get the proponents to come make their presentation, the opponents to make their presentation, and then have all of you available for questioning, because I think several rounds of questions from this many people, we probably use up all our time asking you questions, which, of course, would be very productive, but we do want to hear from the proponents and opponents as well. Yeah. So if we could have the proponents come up. When I say all the witnesses, I'm not referring to the cash discussion that's going to take place after Prop 25, just the Prop 25 discussion. So if I could have the proponents come up. And we'll start a list of questions. If people have questions, just let me know and I'll put you on the list. You've got number one. Okay, whichever one of you would like to start, please identify yourself and go ahead. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Thank you for the opportunity to testify about this vital proposition. My name is Lillian Taze, and I am the president of the California Faculty Association, which represents 22,000 professors, librarians, coaches, and counselors in the California State University system. In a recent column, George Skelton of the LA Times said that, quote, the two-thirds hurdle is the biggest single cause of dysfunction in the state capitol. His words echo what so many of us feel around the state that rely on state funding to do our work. The budget process obviously desperately needs reform, which is why the California Faculty Association is supporting Prop 25. We feel that Prop 25 helps to fix, it's not perfect, but it helps to fix California's broken budget process with reforms that protect taxpayers, schools, and services, while at the same time holding legislators accountable when they fail to pass a budget on time each year. Specifically, Proposition 25 breaks budget deadlock by allowing a majority of legislators to approve the budget, just like 47 other states. It, as has been mentioned, requires legislators to permanently forfeit pay and per diem for each day the budget is late. As also has been indicated, Prop 25 does not lower the two-thirds vote required to raise taxes, and that has been taken through the courts, as you all know. Under our current system, just a few legislators can hold up the budget in favor of issues that are unrelated to the budget. Meanwhile, the rest of us are the ones that get punished, and the funding for schools and universities and public safety and vital services becomes really a bargaining chip. I can tell you from personal experience that the uncertainty caused by delayed budgets creates havoc on the campuses of the CSU. Not only students who can't get their Cal grants on time, and for them that means that they spend the beginning of the quarter or the semester instead of getting on the right track in their studies, scurrying around trying to desperately figure out how they're going to survive that year without their Cal grants. On campuses, down on the ground on the campuses where we're trying to provide quality education for our students, we can't plan how many classes we're going to provide or how many services we're going to be available for students in the fall term. We have no idea how many people are going to have jobs or how many people are going to lose their jobs. It absolutely creates havoc. And system-wide, by November, we are going to have to come up with yet another budget for next year, but we don't even know what this year's budget is going to be. And so I can't really emphasize too much the chaos that all of this creates. And yes, it's not perfect, but we need to move in a direction where we can actually have a meaningful budget in the state. We lose millions of dollars as a consequence of being 80 plus days behind in passing our budget. Those resources we desperately need on our campus to enroll students and keep the classes going and keep people employed. But we can't, it's so painful to watch those resources being flushed down the toilet because we can't move the budget process forward. We really need Prop 25 to help us begin to reform what is clearly a dysfunctional system and give us a fighting shot to bring our state back from this precipice that we're hanging over. It is really a really incredibly critical proposition for us at this moment.
Thank you. Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm Trudy Schaefer, representing the League of Women Voters of California. And I also thank you all for the opportunity to speak to you and through you to the public about Proposition 25. You've already heard everyone saying it's a common sense reform measure. It's not complicated. I won't tick off its very simple provisions. But I will say that the League, like most Californians, are sick and tired of statements made year after year like, this budget has plenty in it for everyone to hate. We deserve better than that, and we believe that it's time to mend our dysfunctional system so budget priorities can be set that make our state vibrant and productive again. What's wrong with the two-thirds vote requirement? It allows a minority of the legislature, actually a minority of one house of the legislature, to stymie the budget process. And it allows the majority to avoid compromise by pointing to the minority's ability to stall the process. And I think both of those elements are important to keep in mind. This doesn't serve anyone well. It certainly enables individual legislators and special interests to game the system. And I have a paragraph of examples from a year or so ago that I think I won't try to go into because I want to speed things up and because every year there's something of this nature, either of an appropriation that someone feels very strongly they want but that would not normally happen in a situation where priorities are being set and stuck to if we're in a difficult year, or sometimes it's something completely unrelated to the budget that is won by in this process of budget negotiations because it's so difficult to come to a conclusion. This kind of legislative gridlock caused by the two-thirds vote requirement leads to late budgets. It creates unnecessary costs for the state. You've heard from my colleague how it leads to problems for the university systems and for local governments that can't plan and that can't see, in the case of, for example, schools, the money that they need because they've begun and their budgets are well underway. And it is not fair to state contractors who get stiffed. And when we have this revenue of delays, the funds that finally are collected by the state often fall short. Yes, when revenues are delayed. This all-consuming focus on the budget also means that really important issues to the people of California are given short shrift: health care, education, prisons, water. So we need to avoid this problem, which really encourages and it also entrenches partisanship. Legislators, you all know, you're stuck with a situation where sometimes there is a refusal to compromise and to work across the aisle. You have to play to your core constituencies. And moderates are often afraid to vote for the budget because they consider that what comes out is political suicide. And that allows you to avoid responsibility for doing the job and making hard choices. These budget shenanigans, one of the reasons why we are so concerned is that they erode public trust and confidence in government. And in all of the talk about reform of governance over these last couple of years, this has always come up as one of those crucial aspects, that unless the public can trust our system more than they can now, it's very difficult to get them to buy into improvements in that system. And of course, the inability to adopt a budget on time hurts our credit rating and increases the cost to the state to borrow money. Some would argue, and Mr. Nielsen, you commented that a two-thirds budget requirement is intended to encourage consensus and discourage partisanship. And while that may be true in theory, it really hasn't worked that way in practice. I would refer to a quote from the California Citizens Budget Commission in its report in 1998. They said, defended as a restraint on spending, there is no clear evidence that this supermajority requirement does in fact have that effect. Legislators can as easily withhold votes to secure increases in spending for their favorite programs as they can to secure spending reductions. So why does the League support Proposition 25? Members of the League of Women Voters have studied state and local government finances since 1969 and updated that study some five times since then. And in basic form, we support a simple majority vote by the public or on the local level, sometimes the governing body, the governing body or the local public, to adopt, repeal, or change finance measures. We believe that we need to have flexible government processes, and so we support the adoption of budgets by a simple majority. We think that Prop 25 will get us out of this, help us get out of this dysfunctional budget process we're in now. It will prevent that minority from stymieing the adoption of a budget, and it will make the majority and the whole legislature accountable for their budget choices. If the majority overreaches in their budget, it can be used against them. Voters can vote them out. We do note that Prop 25 holds legislators, you all, accountable by withholding salary and per diem until the budget is passed, and that that can't be paid to legislators at a later date. Overall, we believe that majority rule is a fundamental concept in representative government, and imposing a supermajority vote for budgets is bad public policy. As you know, California is just one of three states that requires a supermajority vote to pass a budget, the other two being Arkansas and Rhode Island. There's been some mention of the question of whether Prop 25 would allow increases in taxes by a simple majority. And we were pleased that the Court of Appeal was very explicit in their opinion in upholding the title and summary as they had been written, quoting that, in fact, no, it does not allow for tax increases with a simple majority. One of the statements from that opinion was read, but I'll read another. By definition, appropriations are not taxes. We find nothing in the substantive provisions of Proposition 25 that would give a green light to the legislature to circumvent the existing constitutional requirement of a two-thirds vote to raise taxes. We know Proposition 25 won't solve all the problems that we are facing. We need to look at a variety of reforms, a variety of improvements to governing this great state. This is an incremental approach. It doesn't do everything that many people would like it to do, but we do think that it will help put a stop to budget games and to gridlock. It will hold the legislature accountable when you can't do your jobs. And for those reasons, we urge the voters to vote yes on Prop 25. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Schaefer. Mr. Olson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm Lance Olson. I'm an attorney with the law firm of Olson, Hagel, and Fishburne here in Sacramento. And I am counsel to the Yes on 25 committee, and specifically I was the attorney representing the Yes on 25 committee in the litigation that preceded
the publication of the ballot pamphlet in the case that Mr. Taylor quoted from and now Ms. Schaefer just quoted from. And I'd like to spend a couple of minutes just talking about that case, the background on that case, and how it came to be. As you know, the Attorney General prepared a title and summary for Prop 25 that included the statement that it retains the two-thirds vote requirement for tax increases. The opponents of Prop 25 brought a lawsuit challenging that statement, arguing that it was false and misleading and should not be included as the ballot title and summary and the ballot label that would be sent to all of the voters here in California. That lawsuit was heard initially by a Superior Court judge here in Sacramento who did not agree with the opponent's position that there was somehow a hidden provision or some loophole, if you will, within the text of Prop 25 that would have allowed the legislature to enact a tax increase through an appropriation bill that was passed by a majority vote if Proposition 25 should become law. Instead, the court erroneously concluded that actually the language was misleading because he thought it would compel voters to vote for the measure in order to preserve the two-thirds vote requirement. That case was then appealed immediately to the Third District Court of Appeal here in Sacramento, and it was within 72 hours the Court of Appeals reversed the trial court, finding that his reasoning was actually wrong, and even if it might be a reasonable position to take, that's not the standard that you apply when you evaluate a title and summary. Instead, you have to defer to the judgment of the Attorney General. But more importantly, and I think very significantly, the Court of Appeals went on to address very specifically the allegations that the opponents of Prop 25 had made in the trial court, and which, by the way, they repeated in the Court of Appeal, which was that Prop 25, in fact, would allow a tax increase by a simple majority. And I think in a completely unequivocal opinion, I mean, it's hard to find a more direct and clear statement from a Court of Appeal that Prop 25, there is absolutely nothing in Proposition 25 that it would allow this body, if it should become law, to pass a tax increase by a majority vote. The language of Prop 25 is very clear, and as the Court of Appeals said, and as Mr. Taylor quoted, there is no substantive provision in 25 that would allow the legislature to do that. I think that issue is over. I don't think it could be any clearer than what the Court of Appeals has now ruled. Now, Mr. Taylor pointed out that the opinion is unpublished at this point. That is technically correct. That had more to do with the expediency of the requirement that the Court of Appeals rule immediately so that the publication of the ballot pamphlet could go forward. But both the opponents and proponents have submitted a letter to the Supreme Court asking the Supreme Court to publish the decision, and significantly, the Court of Appeals sent its own letter asking the Court of Appeals to publish the decision. So I fully expect that this will be a published decision very, very shortly. There's one other matter I wanted to address, and that has to do with a claim that has been made by the opponents to Prop 25, which is that somehow Prop 25 takes away the right of referendum. And because appropriation bills can now, that are related to the budget, and the budget bill can be passed by majority vote and will take effect immediately, that there would not be a right of referendum to those appropriation bills. Well, we don't necessarily disagree with that in the sense that that would be the effect, but that is the effect currently. And we have not taken away the right of the referendum because there is no right to referendum and appropriation bill currently. That's already in the Constitution, and Prop 25 does not change that. It is true that the vote will change from two-thirds to majority, but of course that's the whole point of Proposition 25, to allow a majority of legislators to enact a budget bill and appropriation bills related to the budget. Thank you.
Thank you very much. If we could have the opponents come up, Mr. Wolf and Mr. Hines. And if the proponents could stay, as well. I think we'll, because afterwards we'll have questions to any and all of you.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chair, members. My name is Greg Hines. I'm representing the California Manufacturers and Technology Association today in strong opposition to Proposition 25. I'd like to thank you all for holding this informational hearing and for presenting me with the opportunity to present. We stare down 85 days since the fiscal year began, and we currently don't have a budget. I think everybody in this room actually is in agreement that that's a problem. I think everybody in this room would also agree that not only do we need to solve this budget, but we also need to make sure that we have on-time, balanced budgets in the future going forward. However, I think that's where the agreements probably end for most people in this room. Prop 25 does not solve that goal. Some of the proponents spoke about uncertainty. Absolutely. The business community talks about the lack of certainty and the lack of predictability all the time in this building. We have none. If you want to talk about past budget problems that have been pervasive in this building, that have caused businesses to struggle to keep open, to make decisions to invest elsewhere, we all agree that this is a problem. The chair mentioned in his opening statements about last year's budget with single sales factor, net operating losses, and whatnot as concessions. I will point out that those were overwhelmingly supported. Those are majority vote to pass items. However, 63 members of the Assembly passed those items last February. 27 members of the Senate passed those similar items that same night. Now, we can all debate about why those votes were made, but they were overwhelmingly passed at the time. Talk about uncertainty. The business community planned on those to come into effect January 1, 2011, and no sooner had the ink been dry on the February 09 budget, we're now staring at efforts to repeal those in Prop 24, which I understand there's a hearing next week for. There are legislative efforts to repeal them and the whatnot. So while I can appreciate the proponents' concerns about uncertainty, let's not forget the effect that the decisions that are made here and in the initiative process have on the uncertainty in the business community, and the effect that that have on our future ability here in this building to effectively govern and budget. I'd like to address three main, I call them myths, with regards to the proponents of Prop 25 arguments. And then I'll allow Mr. Wolf to go a bit more in detail on some of the content. For starters, let's talk about this idea of this being reform. This is the one thing that we don't believe Prop 25 actually has. It doesn't really have any reform. Every bipartisan reform effort that has looked at reforming the state budget process, including the California Constitution Revision Commission, and most recently California Forward, has agreed that any real budget reform must include three things: spending restraints, long-term planning, and rainy day reserves. We see none of that in Proposition 25. In fact, we believe from the opposing side that Prop 25 contains not only none of these, but instead provides more power to some of the very people that have helped get us in the current budget morass that we're in today. That's completely unacceptable. Let's look at this idea about the stick that is being provided here. Proponents claim that Prop 25 will hold legislators accountable for late budgets. They're very clever to say no budget, no pay. Okay. The glaring omission there, however, is that, as Mr. Taylor pointed out, the proposition only requires the legislature to send a budget. Regardless of the gimmicks, regardless of the regular hijinks that we all know has happened in the past budgets and would most certainly be exacerbated on an ongoing basis if we just needed to get a budget sent to the governor, regardless of his action, to make sure that paychecks were coming again. Let's talk a little bit about this issue of revenues. The proponents claim that the proposition does not allow for revenues to be raised by a simple majority. Okay, we disagree, but that's okay. Let's pretend that that's an accurate statement. If we are to take those claims at face value, then I would ask you all, why are we even here dealing with this measure? The annual or quarterly, as it may seem, chronic budget impasse we face here has nothing to do with the majority's inability to get a revenue-free spending plan approved by two-thirds. We haven't really seen a revenue-free spending plan proposal by the majority in this body. The impasse is always and continues to come about due to both sides' inability to agree on whether revenue should be a part of the spending plan. Going down the proponent's path, the suggestion seems to be now that if the majority leadership down in LA today negotiating on hopefully closing the budget were to offer a no revenue enhanced budget proposal that prioritized California needs, funded the state appropriately within its own means, that the minority party leadership, are we supposed to assume that the minority leadership would oppose that? I'm pretty sure that's what the minority leadership is asking for, is a no revenue based budget proposal. But this says, this doesn't add any revenues. We can pass a majority vote budget, but only with what we have available to us. Well, if that's the case, I would posit that if you were to present, as the majority, a non-revenue-based budget proposal today, we would be done with it right now. But that hasn't happened. As so, given this theory, it appears to be the basis of Prop 25 proponents' arguments, and I believe this proposition is either intellectually dishonest about the tax hikes being prohibited, or else this is just another misguided budget fix that actually fixes nothing. We strongly encourage a no on Proposition 25 in November, and further encourage this legislature to put the current impasse behind us. Let's go out there, get a real balanced, structurally sound budget in place so that we all, business, government, and most importantly, all Californians out there can get back to real work. Thanks again for the time.
Thank you. Mr. Wolf.
Mr. Chairman, members, David Wolf here with the Howard Jarvis Taxpayers Association, and HJTA is also opposed to Proposition 25. Members, this has been referenced. Proponents claim that the measure does not increase taxes. But I'd posit to you, what sense does it make to increase spending without adopting new revenue options needed to ensure that the new programs you all want are put in place and affected? And I would just start out by presenting that. Proposition 25 states very clearly that appropriations related to the budget bill would need only a majority vote. Proponents argue that these appropriations cannot contain a tax increase, but there's no provision in Prop 25 or in any other provision of the Constitution that says an appropriation and a tax increase cannot be included in the same bill. To be clear, we believe tax increases can be included in an appropriations bill or a trailer bill related to the budget bill and passed with a majority vote under Prop 25. Speaking directly to the third DCA decision, it's important to note that the court spoke only to the language in the ballot title and summary and not to the implementation of the measure itself. And some elaboration is indeed needed here. It is in fact true that provisions related to Article 13A, Section 3 of the state constitution, that section governing Prop 13 regarding a two-thirds vote for taxes, are not directly altered. That is true. Standalone bills for oil severance taxes, income taxes, sales taxes, and other taxes would still require a two-thirds vote. Again, standalone bills. Indirectly, however, we do believe that the provisions of Proposition 13 are dramatically altered. There's a new section created in the Constitution under Prop 25, Section 12E1 of Article 4, and that section states, quote, notwithstanding any other provision of law or this Constitution, appropriations related to the budget bill require a majority vote. I'm paraphrasing. But the important section there is notwithstanding any other provision of law or the Constitution. We do believe this speaks directly to Proposition 13 and the fact that it would no longer apply to tax increases within budget appropriations bills. And we call it simply the Prop 25 carve-out for tax increases with a majority vote. To be abundantly clear, members, if the proponents desire to eliminate the two-thirds vote for tax increases, if they desired to keep it intact, they could have included a sentence in the measure saying that nothing in the measure is meant to harm the two-thirds vote for tax increases and not include them on a majority vote within budget appropriations related to the budget. That sentence was not included in the measure, and it's not clear. regarding the referendum issue. Mr. Olson and others have rightly stated that tax increases approved by the legislature with a two-thirds vote, such as what happened last year, as well as urgency bills, are not subject to referendum. But yet again, beyond creating that new carve-out for tax increases within the budget passed by a majority vote, Prop 25 also establishes a new criteria for these bills. Again, members, I'd return you to Section 12E1 of Article 4, where, and I'll read it again. Notwithstanding any other provision of law or of this Constitution, the budget bill and other bills provided for appropriations related to the budget bill may be passed by each House by a roll call vote entered in the Journal with a majority vote to take effect immediately. Members, urgency measures under current law require a two-thirds vote. There is no such distinction for measures which are to take effect immediately. This means that tax increases and appropriations bills related to the budget could be passed with a majority vote without any way for voters to take action at the ballot box. Let me give you an example. Some of us remember Senate Bill 2, the pay-to-play employer health care measure that was passed in 2003 and was subject to a referendum under Proposition 72 in 2004. I'd submit to you, members, that as long as this measure is passed in such a way, if Prop 25 were to pass, as long as measures like SB 2 are passed in such a way where they are, quote, related to the budget bill, unquote, in the event that happens, they will be immune from even the possibility of referendum, never mind a vote of the people. And lastly, members, just in regards to legislator pay, it's been brought up by both Mr. Hines and Mr. Taylor that all individuals of the legislature would need to do in order to continue to receive pay is to pass a budget and send it to the governor. And we believe that especially if legislators have the ability under Prop 25 to pass a budget with tax increases passed by a majority vote, that this would not be a hard threshold to meet. I'd submit to proponents that the populist angle they are articulating, saying legislators will not get paid, is simply not accurate. So for those reasons, we'd ask for a no vote or a no on the proposition.
Great. Thank you, everyone, for your testimony. And what I'll do now is I frame the debate with some basic questions, so I'm not going to ask a lot of questions. I do have one clarification question. I'll move to the vice chair for a few questions, and then we're starting a list here for members' questions, and I will move into that category, adding a few things. But just a point of clarification, something Mr. Hines said, that the proposition would give power back to the people who are responsible for this mess, and I wasn't exactly sure whom you were referring to. Could you clarify who it is that is responsible for the mess that this proposition would give the power to?
Again, and thank you for the question, Mr. Chair. It's a very broad statement. It's really not directed at any one individual. It's the legislative body at a whole. I think there's little disagreement that legislators who have controlled the budget process, rightfully so, have gotten us to where we are today. If you lower the threshold to make it easier for whatever to happen, in my mind, logic dictates that it will make it easier for more of a mess to be occurred.
Yet it would be a different group in the sense that it would be a majority as opposed to a two-thirds group.
I would venture to wager that it would be a smaller group of the same, but.
Well, I find the logic there a little bizarre. I mean, in effect, what this whole proposition would do is it would change the dynamic of which group is, whether it's the problems that I raised at the beginning, having to get to a 54 vote threshold in the assembly, and what leveraging and things of that nature are put into the budget, or whether it's into a traditional majority situation, I would contend are two different groups. But I don't want to have our whole discussion on that.
If I could just add one more on that, thank you. To my earlier point on the revenues issue, I don't see that this addresses the problem that you are speaking to, Mr. Chair. The Proposition 25, if it is true that you are not allowed to raise revenues through taxes as a result of the budget process, then you'll be in no different position than you are today. Every budget proposal that the majority has proposed over the last, well, let's say 4 years, and I'm sure it goes beyond, has included some revenue enhancement in it, whether it's an outright tax, whether it's a fee, or whether there's debate among what we're going to call either one of those. And so,
Okay. Let's move on to the next question.
But last August wasn't a budget, was it?
We won't have a free-for-all on this. Let's just move forward. In terms of whether or not that's true, there's certainly the issue of issues that have nothing to do with taxes or revenues, such as the open primary, that got leveraged onto the budget would certainly be it. There would be a different dynamic for those kinds of leveraging of issues. Another question I want to throw out, and then I'll move to the vice chair, is just what I haven't heard from all of you and what I'd like to hear is how we compare to other states. And maybe, Mr. Taylor, you might want to take the lead on this question. And, you know, has the problem of majority rule been an awful problem in other states that have required a two-thirds? What other states require both two-thirds for taxes and for budgeting?
I think, as Ms. Schaefer mentioned, there are two other states that have a supermajority, either two-thirds or three-fourths. That's Arkansas and Rhode Island. There are six other states that have supermajority votes required on the budget in certain circumstances. If the budget goes past a certain date, or if they spend beyond a certain ceiling. And I don't know, Mr. Chairman, how often those kick in. On the two-thirds vote on the taxes, there are several others that it looks like there's about 12 or 13 that have either 60, two-thirds, three-fourths requirements for taxes. So it's more common.
I'll turn to Mr. Nielsen, Vice Chair, for your question, and then we'll move to the list. Mr. Calderon.
I'd say already there's evolving the legal ambiguity. One court finding one way, another court finding another. This is not presidential, not a published decision. It certainly is an offering that there will be lengthy litigation. I would view this majority vote, as I stated earlier, as inviting more spending every year in the budget. Could someone offer to me what provisions in this Prop 25 would invite prudence, less spending, critical, almost zero-based budgeting scrutiny of the agencies of government, rather than simply more budgeting every year? What provisions would give comfort, if any?
Mr. Nielsen, Trudy Schaefer. The point that we've just been hearing some discussion about, the lack of a change in the two-thirds vote for tax increases, to me, is a major part of the answer to you. What this will do, and as I said in my prepared statement, not everyone agrees that it should be as simple as just two-thirds change to majority for the budget. But what it would do is it would mean that those who can pass a budget with a majority vote will have to set priorities. And there will be changes, because those priorities may well mean cuts that people won't want to see, but they will at least mean, I think, a fuller, more robust discussion of where the spending that can be done will actually have to happen. There won't be the ability to, within that discussion, if there are people who just will not accept, when they look at what really needs to be funded by government, if they won't accept more funding, it won't necessarily happen.
Well, I'm afraid I've been around too long to buy that assumption. The bias is always to spend more on most members, even Republican members.
Sir, I do agree with you, but I also would point out that this is something that's in the Constitution, and it's a constitutional change that takes us over decades. We've had plenty of times when the state has not been in the kind of straits that we're in now, and a majority vote would be a real improvement then. Sometimes, I believe, when the situation is that we have a surplus, or at least that we're making ends meet, the pressure is not to increase spending, but to increase tax expenditures and to make the amount of money that's available for our spending programs less. And we certainly have seen a lot of that sort of thing in past years.
Now, there have also been provisions in the past required some return to the taxpayers. That even happened on one occasion. What opportunity for any taxpayers to gain the benefit of excessive revenues would this allow?
Mr. Nielsen, if I might, I'll address that. David Wolf here with Howard Jarvis. And the concern that we have, especially since we do believe the measure would allow for tax increases on a majority vote, is that Prop 25 does nothing to sort of increase that transparency that I think are important to taxpayers. How does it impact taxpayers? Prop 25, in our view, would do nothing to inhibit out-of-control spending if you allowed tax increases to pass with a majority vote. It does nothing to eliminate California's $19 billion budget deficit and force the state to live within it in its means. What it does do is make it easier to pass tax increases, like the $12.6 billion worth of exactions that were passed last year, very regressive income car sales, and the removal of the, at least in part, of the child dependent credit, to the tune of $1,200 a year for a family of four. And I think that's what Proposition 25 helps to perpetuate, more exactions against California taxpayers and families.
Thank you. Well, just one more on this particular point. We all are well aware of what legislative intent, and the reference to the two-thirds vote is contained in legislative intent. The court decisions here referenced relate to the ballot argument. However, conspicuous absent in the, at least in Section 4, is any reference to Prop 13. Why was that omitted from Section 4, C1? Any reference to Prop 13? Article 13.
There is a reference in the initiative. It's in the intent language.
That's not as powerful as the language.
I disagree, because it is as powerful, and there's a Supreme Court decision, the Kempton case, which interpreted the initiative that allowed for contracting out-of-state services with Caltrans, makes it very clear that you look at the entire language of the initiative, including the intent language. That's the Kempton decision. And, in fact, the Court of Appeals came to that exact same conclusion. And I would also point out that, in response to your statement that there's differences of opinion within the courts, there's actually four judges who've looked at the question, does it allow for tax increases by majority vote? All four said no. It clearly does not do that. The trial court came to a different conclusion with respect to the title and summary, but not with respect to the question of the tax increase. And I would also point out is if the opponents really believe that Prop 25 allows for it, then why did they submit a request to the Supreme Court to publish this decision? It makes no sense at all. Obviously, they want it published because they want a Court of Appeal opinion out there that makes it unambiguous that Prop 25 does not allow a majority of the legislature to increase taxes.
And would you then address the absence of any reference to 13A in this measure?
It's not necessary because it's in the measure. It's in the intent language. And as I just explained, when it's in the intent language, that's the same as it's in the initiative. And there's a Supreme Court case that says that.
I do not argue to be an attorney, but I just would at least argue that I would dispute that. Mr. Taylor, could not trailer bills, which would have obvious fiscal implications but very significant policy implications, be included here under this concept? A lot of very substantial policy changes in trailer bills.
Well, Assemblyman, do you mean different from what we do now?
Yes.
I'm not sure how it necessarily changes from what we do now. Mm-hmm. It certainly gives some different incentives to members of the legislature.
But if they had fiscal implications that would require a majority vote, could not then some trailer bill language of a policy consequence with fiscal consequences somewhere slip through with a majority vote?
If there's an appropriation that's put into the bill, yeah, I mean, and it's listed in the budget bill as kind of being this related to the budget bill, you could put, I think, anything that meets those requirements and doesn't otherwise violate other provisions of the Constitution, such as this single subject rule or things like that.
That would certainly be a concern to me. Would it not be possible, as far as the punishment of the legislators provision, the governor submits the budget 1st of January. Couldn't the legislature pass a budget anytime within the next few weeks or few months? taken care of that issue the legislature did pass. It does not require it to have been presented to the governor, nor in fact signed to the governor. So isn't this a pretty easy test to meet? I mean, some budget provisions have been passed early on in session most of the last 2 years. A whole budget could pass just as quickly. It could be written and prepared to be presented even before the governor submitted his budget. Is that not right?
If I could, sir, thank you. We would believe that that's accurate, exactly accurate, and in fact, February 2009 is a prime example of that. We technically passed the 09 budget in February, one of the earliest budgets that this body has ever passed. We did have to come back again, I believe it was end of July, early August, some time frame of last year. Technicality as to whether we would call that a budget or not, but again, the actual budget was passed in February of 09.
Okay, this last, and I just note there was kind of a Freudian slip a while ago. The majority vote was characterized as majority rule. I think that's an instructive slip. Mr. Chairman, thank you for the opportunity to ask questions.
Great. Thank you very much, Mr. Vice Chair. Next will be Mr. Calderon, followed by Mr. Swanson. Mr. Calderon.
All right. I'll sort of preface my questions with a statement, and that being it's very difficult to listen to this debate because I was here when initiatives were passed that have completely tied the legislature's hands in terms of getting a budget in on time. So placing this, placing the issue of the budget in the hands of the people that created it is actually a true statement. It's gonna be placed in the hands of the people who have voted for all the initiatives that require a two-thirds vote for revenue, require a two-thirds vote for budget, require a two-thirds vote to take away any tax break for any corporation or anyone else, requires 60 cents or 40 cents out of every dollar to go to the public schools, require that legislators only serve a specific term and they're out so that there is no institutional memory or experience to be able to deal with these issues. So in that sense, I agree with your statement. But I see this debate as being much more valuable in dealing with the gorilla in the room, and that is if people want a budget on time, make this a majority vote state. That's all they have to do. Make it a majority vote state. We are a constitutional form of government. We are a democracy. Why is it that majority rule doesn't prevail? In every other democracy, majority rule prevails except for California. So until we get majority rule so that we can place the blame or the praise squarely on the legislators that vote for one budget or another, we're going to have all of this debate going on, which is totally unrelated to fixing any kind of a problem. And so it's just difficult for me to listen to this. But having said that, I do have some questions. I have to say one other thing. People in my district every day, in one way or another, come to me, and in one form or another, perhaps not in a letter, perhaps not in any formal statement, perhaps not even in any direct statement, but in their eyes and in their hopes and dreams as they express them to me, they ask that I care enough about this community to make their lives better. And no other vote is probably more important than the vote that we're going to make on the budget. And this initiative is going to say, it's going to answer the question, because the question for 20 years for me has been, was I elected to come up here and represent my district? Was I elected to come up here and represent the people who have no voice and to do my best job in making decisions and use my best talents? Or was I just elected to come up here and vote for a budget? Well, if I talk to people in my district, they're saying, please help us in any way you can. But when we get to Sacramento, the rhetoric and the politics and the party is vote for a budget, vote for a budget, vote for a budget. And now this initiative will allow us to vote for a budget. And the schools will know tomorrow who they have to fire. They'll know tomorrow how many children are going to be in each classroom. And it's going to have to be done before June 15. And so they're going to know well in advance, but be careful what you ask for. Because under this, legislators are placed in direct conflict now between their own survival and voting for a budget. And since the requirement is to submit that budget by June 15, that now becomes the floor for anything that follows, if in fact anything does follow. But you know, if there's any benefit, at least it does tend to identify who is responsible for what. And perhaps that's good. Having said that, does this initiative, in the opinion of the proponents or you, Mr. Taylor, require that the balance that be submitted be a balanced budget?
Yeah, I think other provisions of the Constitution would still require the same thing as what is now required.
And so now how can you submit a balanced budget without appropriations or necessary appropriations? So this will require an all-cuts budget without any other revenue accelerations or revenue increases or any of these other things that we try and do to raise revenue.
I think that's correct.
All right.
Mr. Chairman, if I might, just real briefly.
Very, very briefly, because we have a lot of member comments.
No, absolutely. Just want to speak briefly to a couple issues. First of all, majority vote budgets solving the problem. It's not true. Majority vote budgets don't solve at all the problem of an on-time budget. I'd submit since 2002, according to the National Conference of State Legislators, 16 states with majority vote requirements have failed to pass a budget.
I want to limit your comments to answering the questions because we already had your presentation. So if it, specifically at Mr. Calderon's question, otherwise you can incorporate the statement into the next question that's relevant.
Well, specifically to his question, he's addressing that majority vote budgets solve the problems with the late budgets that we're facing. And again, just to make the case, we don't believe that is the case. Again, 16 states with a majority vote budget since 2002 have failed to pass one on time. There's two states this year, New York and Pennsylvania, that were unable to pass budgets on time. So just to make the point, we don't believe that even if Prop 25 were to pass, it would solve the problem.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Swanson,
thank you,
followed by Mr. Fuhrer. Go ahead, Mr. Swanson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First of all, it is extremely unfortunate that this discussion of Prop 25 has taken such a partisan character because I think every citizen in our great state of California has run out of patience for the fact that we cannot pass a budget on time. That's not just Democrats or Republicans or independents. It's all of Californians are really disgusted with the fact that we can't pass a budget on time. And there are consequences to each Californian. Businesses suffer, schools suffer, citizens suffer, all of us suffer from it. And so to suggest that Proposition 25 would not help the gridlock that currently exists in Sacramento is really a ludicrous. I mean, it's just an absurd notion. Of course, it will help, and I think Mr. Taylor, the legislative analyst, said that this is a pretty straightforward and simple measure, and I think that that's true. Now, I will tell you, I, for one, wish it did include tax increases, the ability to increase revenue, to solve problems and create priorities, but it doesn't. And the courts have said it doesn't. Credible analysis of the proposition says that it simply means that a simple majority can pass a budget. And for anyone to suggest that if the budget is passed on time by a simple majority, that it won't be signed, that would be up to the governor, whoever he may be. And so I think that we need to put this in to the proper perspective. Those that are arguing against this proposition seem to be satisfied with the current situation of gridlock, and it's unacceptable, and that's why we're here. We're not all satisfied because the question of revenue still has to be addressed in the future. But I would suspect that with the passage of 25, come the constitutional deadline, a budget will be passed, and then it will be, and it may be passed with the revenues that exist, and it may be signed by a governor that that wants to move the state forward. It doesn't eliminate the ability for two-thirds of the House to come together and agree that we need more revenues to fund priorities like schools. But that is really clear, and it's just disturbing to me that this campaign has started off on my way to Sacramento today, driving up here. I heard an ad that talks about Proposition 25 will raise taxes on the citizens in California, raise your income tax, your home tax, I mean, this is every tax possible. That's a very disingenuous campaign. It's not an honest campaign. And to try to confuse voters about a measure, a straightforward measure like this, I think is extremely unfortunate and doesn't serve the state. And so I would ask Mr. Taylor again, in your opinion as legislative analyst, does this proposition raise taxes or allows for a simple majority of tax increases on the people of the state of California?
Well, again, I'm not a lawyer, so I'm not trying to be legislative counsel, but I think it's there's a huge burden that people trying to make that argument would have in going to the courts. That is, I think the two-thirds vote to increase taxes would still be in place.
Thank you, and I hope that as this matter goes forward, that the people of California read the initiative, and that's what this hearing is supposed to be about, us clarifying the purpose of the initiative. And this initiative doesn't raise taxes. It simply streamlines the process that allows a simple majority to go on the record and to be held accountable for a budget on time that may or may not be signed by whoever is governor. And I would ask the proponents of Prop 25 is that in talking to the citizens, are people confused about whether or not this is a measure that clearly will not raise taxes in your encounter, or is it is that developing into some kind of problem and sort of disinformation campaign?
Well, certainly it is. It's problematic when someone suggests that something that simply isn't accurate and makes the job of educating always a challenge. But I think most people are reading the title and summary and sees that it says it does not raise taxes. And the truth is, 85 days into this budget crisis, people are pretty fed up and pretty ready for something, a different approach to budgeting, a different approach to getting things done. People are just kind of tired of seeing it go on and on and on, and there just seems to be no end to it. People are inclined to hope that this will make things better. I think the kinds of disingenuous ads that are coming out will always be problematic, but I think we can make a clear argument, and I'm hopeful that we'll make a clear argument, and if folks are, as I say, really ready to do something different in California, to try a new way, the way that that 47 other states do business, and moving us to a place where things can get better in California.
Finally, Mr. Chairman, what we're trying to do here is very transparent. California loses billions of dollars by these delays. No one likes these delays. Our projects are stalled, and we can't put projects and infrastructure projects on the street. Our bond rating suffers as a result of these delays. So what difference does it make? It makes a big difference to California's ability for its bond rating. Every $1 billion we put on the streets results in 17,000 jobs for Californians. And so this is real business during the time of a very severe recovery for the people of the state of California. And that's why this initiative is so important. And we at least need an honest debate about it. And that's what's frustrating me at this point, is that I see this debate going in the wrong direction. And I appreciate, Mr. Chairman, the hearing where we are trying to clarify. And please.
Thank you, Mr. Swanson.
Mr. Chair, I apologize. Okay. I'm going to need to excuse myself.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for your participation. Before I move on, Mr. Adams will be next, but I just want to remind everyone that briefly the purpose of this hearing, and also remind them of this so that we can get through the hearing quicker because we have a lot of members who wish to speak. The purpose of this hearing is not for us to advocate or on one side or the other, really to get focused on the questions. So members are clearly entitled to make statements that they wish, and I'm not trying to limit anyone's statement, but let's try to focus as much as we can on questions to get at the issues that are involved in this, so everyone can have a better understanding. And let's keep our answers also related just to answering those questions, and not restating opinions about the good or bad, but really answering the factual questions. So with that, Mr. Adams.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate that, and I'll try to make this as focused as possible. By way of the brief statement that you have offered us, I would like to point out that I do think that Mr. Calderon's comments, many of them I would like to align myself with. I do feel very strongly that the state of California has made its own bed and now doesn't want to lie in it. The reality is the initiative process from 1933 on has systematically eroded much of what makes California potentially work. And I hate the idea that we're now faced with another proposal to try to reform California by way of the initiative process. I have yet to see an initiative that I think serves as well as a legislative body vetting and debating and legitimately trying to arrive at a compromise solution. The initiative process, I think, has done far more harm than good. It drives me crazy to think that we are going to be faced with a decision that I think, to Mr. Swanson's point, goes to the exact opposite. And that is, I don't think this does make sense. I don't think it is cogent and that it doesn't attach itself to the taxes. If you, in fact, want to make the majority party responsible for the budget, you need to give them the full panoply of responsibility so the voters will have a decision to be made. The proponents of this measure made the comment early on that they thought that this might lend itself towards holding politicians accountable by making voters aware of who's actually responsible for it. I would suggest to you that there should be no lack of clarity to that question already. But the simple fact of the matter is, in the state of California, when we carry a piece of legislation dealing with dog licenses or neutering in Spain, I get 10,000 phone calls, emails, notes, letters, people pounding down my doors, people coming to my home, people emailing me personally to try to get some resolution to this problem that is so important to them. But when it comes time for the budget, I don't get a call. I don't get hardly a phone ring. Californians do not pay attention to the thing that matters the very, very most to them, and that is the passage of this budget. Because if they saw this, I think they would start to hold those politicians accountable. But unfortunately, we also have gerrymandered districts that make it difficult to get rid of people. We have term limits that make it impossible for members to even speak cogently about most things because they lack a level of experience to even make a difference. And we have so allowed this institution to be corrupted by the ability to jerry-rig it in a manner that does not make members responsible, that I'm not even sure that this is going to be a positive step forward, but could in fact be exactly the opposite. Now that was my brief statement, which wasn't as brief as I'd hoped, but be that as it may, I would like to ask some pointed questions. In the amount of research I've done, Rhode Island and Arkansas come closest to the state of California in terms of their responsibility to have a supermajority, 3/4 and 2/3. Yet in those instances, and they're pointed to all the time as why this is the anomaly and why we should all abandon this because we're only one of three. I ask you the question, how many times have they failed to pass their budget on time?
I'm sorry, Mr. Adams. I've looked at the NCSL website just as far as getting the lists of states that have, as Mr. Taylor mentioned, either always a 2/3 a supermajority vote or under certain circumstances. And I know in the past I've seen that kind of I think I have seen that kind of data. I would have to look for it and try to get back to you.
And what I've discovered Arkansas last had a delayed budget in 2004. Consider, if you will, the gravity of the financial situation that has gripped this entire country, and yet in 2005, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10, they've managed to pass the budget on time, as has Arkansas, yet they have the two-thirds majority. Now, one of my colleagues correctly points out that they likely have enough Democrats to pass it without the minority vote being present. That's fine. The state of California has at its disposal the ability to do the very same thing and hasn't chosen to do so yet. I am also a little bit concerned about accusations of dishonesty. Show me an initiative that is not dishonest, and I'll show you an initiative that doesn't exist. They all are riddled with all kinds of subtle lies, lies of omissions, lies intended to try to convince voters that they're the best thing ever, when in fact they're not. If you really want to make sure that you punish the legislature, do you think holding their legislatures accountable by taking away their pay is going to incentivize them to make a positive budget happen? I would argue that the exact opposite occurs. You're incentivizing a perversely damaged, destructive budget simply to ensure that you have pay coming in for somebody who's trying to meet their basic needs. And lest anyone have any confusion about it, while the legislature certainly makes a more than fair living, unless you're independently wealthy, you're still a family, you still have responsibilities, you still have things. We don't get pensions, we don't get all kinds of the perks that a lot of Californians think we do. And all this would do is incentivize, for a horrifying reason, just trying to make sure that you can make your mortgage payment, a passage of a budget that may not be what's in California's best interest. With that, I thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you much, Mr. Adams. Mr. Fuhrer, followed by Ms. Alquist. Mr. Fuhrer.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. I want to say that I don't think that there is a member here who is satisfied with the status quo when it comes to our budget process. And I don't think we should be striving to align ourselves with positions that are going to keep California's budget process set in its current stone. So the question, if people agree that the status quo doesn't work, the question is not whether it should change, but how it should change. Now, Mr. DeSaunier and I have been chairing a process designed to reform, in large measure, this budget process. And there are many people around this table who are supportive of that effort. I have to say for myself that I think that the ingredient in that set of proposals that would have California move to a majority vote for the budget is a necessary, but it is not a sufficient condition for the changing that we need to make here. I'm a proponent of moving to a robust performance-based budgeting regime. I think we should be taking a longer look at our budget, not just one year at a time. The initiative process has good elements to it, but one thing that needs to change is that a proposal that is going to either increase an existing program or offer a tax break of some kind needs to have its funding source displayed at the outset. A more robust reserve is a good idea. There are a number of things that we should be doing, and I do want to say, since we're talking about reforming the budget process, that I think we shouldn't let go of those and other changes, irrespective of the fact that this particular initiative is before us today. And I will say that coming into the next session, I think Mr. DeSaunier and others will be further pursuing a wider array of changes. But as to this change, I think that there was a valuable dialogue that I think got lost in the shuffle of the balance of this discussion earlier on. This is a constitutional change. This is not a change for the next 30 seconds. So the question is, what is the long view of the impact of this measure? It is not always going to be the case that California is going to be living with such horrible fiscal constraints as we do right now. It's going to change. 10 years ago, just the opposite was the case. 8 or 9 years before that, we were in a recession. The budget and our revenues move in cycles. And so there will be a time when, irrespective of any revenue changes that are imposed legislatively, gubernatorial support, there'll be a time when there's more revenue. Soon. Probably next few years, more revenue than we have now. The question then will be, what are the priorities that are going to guide our decision making? What values will the budget express? The budget is not a green eye shade document for people who are accountants. The budget is an expression of what we care about the most in our state. And there are differences of opinion regarding what the most valued elements are in our state. Around education, around health care, around public safety, the competition among those points. That's where this measure becomes very important. is in times when we are deciding in that competition of values what we care about the most. And at that moment, I don't consider the term majority rule to be pejorative at all. At that moment, the point is, what would the majority of Californians like to see expressed in this key document? That's why I think this is a necessary but an insufficient condition, but a necessary one to move the ball forward, because that day will come. It is not the case that this initiative dictates an all-cuts budget. It dictates nothing about that. Depends what happens with our revenues in the state as the budget moves back and forth. So in our current situation, it would lead in that direction. In 1998, it would have led to a different direction altogether. So if we take the long view, if we are dissatisfied with the status quo, if we think that reflecting our deepest priorities is a good idea in a budget, then I think this has merit to it. It is imperfect, but has merit to it. I want to ask Mr. Olson a question that goes back to some of the legal discussion that was had earlier. The initiative says on its face, under the heading Purpose and Intent, thank you, Ms. Nielsen, this measure will not change Proposition 13's property tax limitations in any way. This measure will not change the two-thirds vote requirement for the legislature to raise taxes. Do you know of any objective legal opinion that says that that language wouldn't control in a subsequent challenge to this measure that is brought to say, no, this is you can raise taxes under this? Is there any existing objective legal opinion that says that those terms wouldn't define the outcome and preclude a raising of taxes pursuant to this measure?
I think the short answer is no. There's no argument to be made that the legislature could, or a court could, ignore that language and reach a conclusion that the legislature could adopt a tax increase by a simple majority vote. I mean, it's just, yeah. It's not a plausible argument. It was an argument that was put forward in the Superior Court. It was an argument that was put forward in the Court of Appeal, and it was resoundly rejected. And I might point out, rejected by four judges who were appointed by Republican governor. So I don't think this is, I mean, I don't think we have to be concerned that somehow there'll be a partisan issue here if this should ever rise again.
Yeah, and I'd like to conclude where I began, which is, so I think that's utterly clear. And I would not want to, as a lawyer, I would not want to be the lawyer to walk into court and say to a panel of judges, hey, by the way, when the voters voted on this very simple, straightforward, not very long initiative, they just ignored the purpose of the initiative, which is where this language is found. That'd be a very tough argument to make.
And I'd also point out that the legislative history now will contain the ballot pamphlet materials, and the Attorney General's title and summary actually says it retains the two-thirds vote requirement. So I can't imagine any court.
Nor can I. Just because of time, I want to conclude with this. I am pleased to hear questions from both sides of the aisle that relate to what other budgetary reforms accompany this one, because it suggests to me, having stood on the other side of that podium during much of the summer urging that we reform how we do the budget process with a number of things that would do just what was asked, it suggests to me that, let's assume this passes, that there will be bipartisan support for a broad array of fundamental changes as to how we do business that did not exist previously. I think it's time, and I think that we have little time to waste. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Fuhrer. Senator Alquist, followed by Mr. Ruskin.
Thank you. Well, it's probably a good thing we're not supposed to be taking positions verbally, because I have no position on this. But I would like, and that is really true, I have no idea what I will do or eventually, well, along that line. But I would like to raise some comments, both positive and strengths and weaknesses. And I know that the million people that I represent in Santa Clara County, in Silicon Valley, both the tech workers, the moms on CalWORKs, all the seniors who live in mobile homes. I have one of the largest mobile home communities in the state. will be interested, hopefully, in at least listening to parts of what I will say. First thing is that it's pretty clear to me that with this proposition, with the simple majority vote, you really could not raise taxes. I truly believe that. And I will look at the scenario where sometimes you need new revenue to support existing programs. That occurs in a Great Recession. It even occurs in a situation we face today where supposedly, and I'm a former financial analyst at Stanford University, where the economy supposedly is tepidly and spasmodically improving. In a situation like this, there needs to be new revenue. And a concern I have with the proposition is that given that you could pass a budget with a simple majority and you can cut programs, but if you truly cannot raise revenues with a simple majority, we are going to have a worse problem than we have today. Another issue I'd like to raise, should this pass, is it's going to be really important that there's no hijinks. And I would define that particularly in a situation where the governor is of one party and the majority of members in both houses are of a different party. It would be easy to say, we passed you a budget on time, and it's your problem because you don't want to deal with it. As I said, I think one of the major problems is that we need to have true accountability, and I agree with some of my colleagues and good friends who were witnesses. I think we really need to hold one party accountable. In ancient Greece, and of course all my family comes from Greece, in the beginning, the leaders had rocks. And when they would vote, they would put their rock for a yes vote in one pile or for a no vote in the other pile. And whoever had one more rock, that's whose policy was implemented. Now, I know it's really different in California today, but the fact is, I don't think it's true accountability unless you have the ability to pass a budget with a simple majority. And for the very scenarios I described earlier, where you are in a great recession, you need the ability to raise revenues. I sure wish I had a better answer. What I do believe, though, is that it was a lot easier before term limits to get a budget. And this will not affect me because come December 2012, I will be out. I will have served the majority in both houses. I will have served 14 years. But the public needs to come to terms with the fact we need people up here who really are experienced, and not to boot them out as soon as we do today. As an example, I look at Assembly members, former Senators Nielsen and Calderon, who I think both have given a really good input. So, in closing, let me say that I think our initiative process is overused. I think we need to do something about term limits. I think we need to operate not out of fear. And as I said, I do believe should the initiative pass, one way to look at it is that it may be a first step, but because it would be constitutional, it would not be easy to change. So thank you for allowing me to speak.
Thank you very much, Senator. Mr. Ruskin, followed by Ms. Harkey.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'd like to make some brief remarks. I want to support especially the remarks made by Mr. Feuer and Mr. Swanson. I think that when you have a process that is inimical to good government, I think that anything that you can do to change that process is a step in the right direction. I think that holding out for total reform, as some might call it, is a utopian, a worthwhile hope, but a utopian one, I fear. And criticizing Prop 25 because it may not produce all the results we hope to have in a particular year is short-sighted. What I would like to do for the remainder of my remarks is read, if I might, from a very conservative document. And I'm going to read excerpts, but I can assure you I'm not changing the intent of what was said. This is from the Federalist Paper 22 by Alexander Hamilton, in which he talks, in fact, about what he thinks about majority, what he thinks about a rule by a two-thirds majority. This was something that was brought up at the time when it was being discussed how to make decisions regarding the new Constitution and the new government. And Alexander Hamilton had the ability, I understand, to observe what two-thirds rule could do because he was able to observe that, I believe, in watching the Polish parliament at the time. And this is what Alexander Hamilton had to say about two-thirds rule. Quote, "What at first sight may seem a remedy is in reality a poison. To give a minority a negative upon the majority, which is always the case where more than a majority is requisite to a decision, is in its tendency to subject the sense of the greater number to that of the lesser. The public business must, in some way or other, go forward. If a pertinacious minority can control the opinion of a majority, respecting the best mode of conducting it, the majority, in order that something may be done, must conform to the views of the minority, and thus the sense of the smaller number will overrule that of the greater, and give a tone to the national proceedings. Hence, tedious delays, continual negotiation and intrigue, contemptible compromises of the public good, and yet, in such a system, it is even happy when such compromises can take place. For upon some occasions, things will not admit of accommodation, and then the measures of government must be injuriously suspended or fatally defeated. It is often by the impracticability of obtaining the concurrence of the necessary number of votes kept in a state of inaction. Its situation must always savor of weakness, sometimes border upon anarchy." End quote. Except for the archaic language, I think Mr. Hamilton was aptly describing the state of California, and I think that his wisdom really informs us that Prop 25 is a step in the right direction.
Thank you, Mr. Ruskin. Ms. Harkey, followed by Mr. Davis.
Yeah, I have a question, excuse me, of probably Mr. Taylor. This passed, well, on, I believe it was the 31st of August, we voted on two budgets, both of which failed. There was a spending plan presented, 90 point something billion, and we are projected to have 83, I think, point 7 billion in revenues. If that spending plan had passed on this majority vote, how would that be implemented?
Well, I'm not sure I know exactly what you mean.
Well, if you have we were told that this was not a budget but was actually a spending plan, which I'm assuming would be like budget bills for $90 billion. If the state of California on a majority vote were to implement a spending plan at $90 billion when we're only taking in $83.7 billion, how would it be implemented?
Well, I guess the usual rules would apply. A governor would have to then act on that plan. And there would have to be some, you know, on its face, how does it meet the balanced budget requirement? So a governor would have to either go along that it's nominally balanced in the documents that would be provided on what the plan consists of. And, I'm not sure I know exactly what you're getting at. If it really isn't balanced, are you asking me what happens?
Yeah, what happens? I mean, if that got passed, it was a bill presented on the floor. It was a serious proposition by the majority party, by the Democrat Party, to spend $90 billion. Maybe it was 97, but I think it was about $90 billion. We presented on the other side of the aisle 83.7, which was the projected revenue. Now, if in fact this majority vote would have been in place, we would have had a $90 billion spending plan, quote unquote. How could that possibly be implemented?
Well, I think you'd have to. It would be left to the governor, in his or her actions, or in this case, in his actions on, you know, whether he would sign that bill, because he could, on its face, conclude that it was balanced.
And if he concluded on its face it were balanced, what effect would trailer bills have on that?
I think that would have to be viewed as part of the whole plan.
Okay, so the trailer bills then would probably need to carry some appropriation?
Well, or some action in the case of a tax increase, for example.
Okay, then this... What you're saying then, that this Proposition 25 then could include tax increases
No, I'm not. I think that's a jump. You asked me what in the plan that was presented. If that plan required tax increases to fund that $90 billion, it would have to be one of the trailer bills that would have to also be signed into effect by the governor as part of the package, because what the Constitution says is that all of your revenues have to at least be equal to or exceed what your appropriations are. And so I'm not sure how the governor could do that if he did not sign the requisite revenue proposals that funded the $90 billion in spending.
Right, but the requisite revenue proposals then to go with the $90 billion budget would need then two-thirds vote off the floor?
Yes.
So the trailer language would need two-thirds?
In that case, yes.
Okay, well, I'm reading here where it says that... Proposition 25 would allow the legislature to enact other bills providing for appropriation related to the budget bill by a mere majority vote, notwithstanding any other provision of law or the Constitution. So that doesn't mean the same thing that I'm hearing here. I'm not trying to put you on the spot, but maybe
I could just follow up before Mr. Olson may want to reply also. As I talked about in my initial comments, there could still be, even under Proposition 25, there could be trailer bills that you have traditionally passed that would still require a two-thirds vote, even under this measure.
Okay,
because they did not include an appropriation. Okay, so there's different provisions going on, but I think what the discussion has been about, the opponents would assert that this provision, by having a notwithstanding a clause and it's included as part of the budget plan, I think they're trying to assert there is still some question as to whether you could, you know, sneak in a tax increase as part of these trailer bills. And I think what seems fairly clear to me is that, based on the court's action, the language in the title, and what the voters would have been told, is that those trailer bills could not include a tax increase unless it had been approved by a two-thirds vote.
So then what, in essence, do you agree with that? I mean, is that your opinion of this language here that I read to you, and I'll read it again? As you know, Proposition 25 would allow the legislature to enact other bills providing for appropriation related to the budget bill.
I agree that that language does not mean that the legislature could adopt a tax increase by simple majority. That's not the intent of that language. The intent of the language was make it clear that appropriation bills would could be passed by a majority vote and that they would take effect immediately. That's the point of the notwithstanding language. With respect to your comment about the spending plan, I would like to back up. I mean, I think the spending plan first has to be a budget bill. I mean, that's what Prop 25 talks about. It talks about, and that's what the Constitution refers to as a budget bill. So I'm not sure what the spending plan was, but it has to be a budget bill. It could be passed by a majority vote. It has to be balanced because Prop 25 doesn't change those provisions and those requirements of the state constitution. And if the governor were to determine in his judgment, her judgment, that it was not balanced, then they could exercise a line item veto and balance the budget through that process. And that Prop 25 doesn't affect that either.
Okay, then I have some more questions here, as well as comments. I'm sorry, and I don't know your name, the lady sitting
Lance
down.
Lance Olson, no, Trudy Schaefer.
Attorney Schaefer. You said that in years past that spending actually decreased when times were good. What years are you referring to?
I don't believe that I said that. I said, if I recall correctly, that what was in the negotiations about a budget included increasing tax expenditures. In other words, reducing tax revenue. And that kind of piece of the negotiations was, in my opinion, as likely in good years as increasing spending on programs. And we certainly have seen increases in tax credits, deductions and so forth, tax expenditures.
Okay, the reason I'm asking that is that our general fund budget actually doubled from 98 to 2008. And we did fill a hole with $15 billion in 2004, and we've continued to escalate. One of the primary reasons, I believe, is that every governor wants to fund education, and they fund it to the max and over. And then you can't go backwards. So that's kind of where we're at right now. We are stuck at this level. Even if we were to have declining enrollment, we cannot decrease the funding. And that's the big debate that's going on right now. Majority rule. Okay, we were founded as a country with representative government, and I understand that we all represent a group of people, so we are the representatives for our districts. However, how this gets skewed in this state, and the reason that we are so lopsided up here is because of the gerrymandered districts. So in quoting Alexander Hamilton, I don't think he had intended gerrymandered districts to the extent that we've got, such that majority rule, actually those who pay the taxes and who pay for the services are quickly falling to less than 50%. Those who receive are skyrocketing. And I think that's one of the problems we're seeing in the state, and especially in this severe downturn and recession. We've seen a really, really strong response statewide, both sides of the aisle, opposed to raising any kind of taxes. So I don't see how this is going to help us. And coming right now, at this time, when people are so upset, they're upset with the federal government, they're upset with the state, I don't know why we're putting more propositions that will further tie and restrain the ability of this legislature to actually get to work. There is nothing, as I understand it, that would stop us, and I saw this, I've only been up here 2 years, or not quite, but there's nothing that would stop us from starting serious budget negotiations very, very early in the year. It just hasn't been done, and I think it's been because of political expediency. The Democrats' spending budget didn't pass by all of their people. I mean, it wasn't like it was 51 to zip, because a lot of people don't want to spend more because they're running for election. The reason that we're having a problem right now in this debate is because we've got a lot of people running for elections. They don't want to necessarily raise taxes right now. They don't want to be seen as a tax increaser. And so we didn't even call the budget hearings till way, way, way late in the season. And so I don't think that this is an honest. I think this whole proposition is very ingenuous and politically calculated to try to, in case the majority party should lose some seats in November, that it wouldn't be quite as hard to cull off as many people. So I see it as very disingenuous. If this were happening next year in a non-election year, I might be more willing to think it wasn't deceitful, but I think it is. I would really like to encourage, since the chair and I both started the assembly in the same year, I would really like to encourage that we work on something so that we could start a budget negotiation a lot earlier in the year, because I think it would be very helpful to have anyone and everyone here, rather than just the conference committees that, you know, don't seem to ever close the gap, that we really start serious negotiations. The state is fundamentally bankrupt, and we did pass taxes in 2009. And it was supposed to be the budget plan that healed all wounds, and it didn't last. And it's not going to last this time. And this $19 billion is going to be another probably who knows how many more billion as soon as we get this solved. And it's because we're bankrupt. We're in a tailspin, and we have to work out of this. I don't know if any of you understand how much debt we have looming in the future. So I don't want to go on about this, but if you think this is going to solve the problem, it's not, because we've got so much outstanding debt and no way to fund it that we've put off over the last couple of years that I've been here and probably even before, that this is not going to solve it. It's just going to make things worse, and constitutionally, so it would be very difficult to change. The priorities of the people of California we can see in the bonds that are passed. Education, public safety, transportation, water. That's what they want us to do. It's not that tough. So, you know, I say to you, I'm disappointed that we're here and the people may be fooled again into thinking they're helping the state, but I guess I kind of expected it's an election year, and I hope that people see through it and just let this legislature do its job. The initiative process is very broken right now, and I would really like to see the legislature just do its job, get together as we should as adults early on, and get this fixed. Our cities do it. Our counties do it. They meet their June 30th deadline. There's no reason why we can't. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Harkey. Mr. Davis, followed by Senator DeSalnier.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I appreciate the opportunity to participate as a member of the body. And in terms of the budget and staying focused, as you've asked us to do, I think that our overwhelming challenge, based upon the calls that I have been getting, at least in Los Angeles, is that we have had a budget that has taken too long, certainly last year and as it appears this year as well. That is our central overwhelming problem and the reason why we're here in this room having this discussion today. Certainly, I wish that the good would not be the enemy of the public, which is often stated in our legislative hearings. And I've heard the numerous problems that exist in the world today and the numerous problems that exist in the legislature today. But taking the assignment of our chairman to remain focused, I acknowledge spending is important. Rainy day funds are critically important. Long-term planning, critically important. Safe districts are certainly in some regards a problem, but in other respects, I mean, what is a safe district? Every one of the 80 districts of the assembly cannot be safe. Needless to say, as we focus, the real problem is that we have taken too long and many of the services that should be delivered with state funding have been hampered because of how long we have taken to push forward a budget in a timely manner. And so this Prop 25 that we talk about and discuss today hopefully will be able to move us forward past a stalemate that we certainly saw last year and obviously we're seeing again this year. This is why we're getting the calls to our office. Healthcare, education, public safety, child care funding, which certainly all of these industries and agencies that depend upon us are having to wait because revenues are not being generated while they are waiting. And so, Mr. Taylor, my question to you is not complex, it's very simple. And as we review the impact of Prop 25 in the budget process in California, will this proposition presented to us that we're discussing today help move this so-called structural stalemate that we have found ourselves in, particularly last year and this year? Those are dramatic examples of where we are. Will a simple majority help in some way to potentially move us forward more expeditiously than in the past? I realize, before you answer the question, that 47 other states, as I've been told, have such a proposal. It doesn't seem that they've withered up and crawled over and died. And so my question to you simply is, will this proposition, this proposal before us, help move this structural stalemate that we have found ourselves in over the last couple of years? And obviously, it could even get worse in future years.
Well, again, I'm going to have to give you a qualified answer. It depends. As I said in my early comments, you may have situations where it won't make much difference at all.
Give me an example.
Well, I would take the current situation where you apparently have a governor, for example, who agrees with members of the minority party that there should be no tax increases. So if you have a majority vote budget, if you'd had it in place now, I'm sure you could have passed a budget to the governor, but I'm not sure he would have accepted it, and you might be in a very similar place that you are now. Other situations, it could make a huge difference. It might make it much easier.
And give me an example of that.
Well, let's say that you have both the governor and both houses of the legislature of the same party. And not only that, they're of a like mind about how the spending priorities should be implemented. You could get a budget very quickly and on time. So the answer is it depends.
Sure.
And it also depends when you say kind of our structural problems. People are talking about a whole array of problems.
Sure. But I also said we couldn't do all of those in one stroke.
Right. It's just that I don't think we're always on the same wavelength as to what problems we're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
For some people, having a budget on time is one of the most important things. For others, having more revenues or control over our revenue source is the most important thing. So it really depends on which problem you're talking about. But again, for the most part, my answer would have to be it depends.
Well, I still think, and I appreciate your answer, that you've given me some substantial and sufficient evidence in terms of which I can begin to lean towards a position. And given the fact that I think that clearly to have a position where we can move forward potentially, at least 50% of your answer is we could potentially move forward, and I would accept that as being sufficient in the right circumstance. I realize that we put no clamps down on the accountability of the governor, and we can't make him responsible to act positively to move a budget forward. But what we can do, I think, by this measure, as has been discussed by those of you presenting today, is make sure that the legislature, through some of the provisions that have been evident in this document, make sure that the legislature is coerced, if you will, for lack of a better word, towards submitting a budget in a timely manner. Now, certainly the public has some work to do in terms of who becomes the governor, and we can only hope that they will do that. But, you know, given your answer, I don't expect this document to be perfect, but I think it is, based upon what I'm hearing you say, a move in the right direction. I don't expect us to get there with the wave of a wand, but I think that it is a move in the right direction towards what my constituents' concerns are, and I believe the concerns of constituents throughout the state. And that is simply, how do we move this particular process to stop the stalemate? I think while it might not move the total process, it does move it towards, particularly as it relates to the legislature, towards submitting a document in a more timely manner than we have in the past. Now, that's just my opinion.
If I could just very quickly add, if your goal is, for example, to have a budget on time, if you think that that's really been a critical problem in recent times, there are other ways to achieve that goal. In the 80s, we had budgets that were fundamentally on time, even though we had two-third vote requirements. And some might argue that it's because there are much fewer consequences of a late budget now than the perception was back in the 80s. That is, if you didn't pass a budget on time, nothing got paid. Currently, we're still paying about two-thirds or more of our state expenses. Now, that has created...
That will stop soon.
Well, but right now, over two-thirds of our payments are still being made. Now, that poses an incredible hardship on the third that aren't getting it. But it's nowhere near the same perspective as we had back in the 80s that, you know what, you had to have a budget close to July 1 or there were real consequences because no one would get paid. And we don't have that anymore. So I just raise that because, again, it depends on what problem you're trying to address or is most important to you. Can Prop 25, if late budgets are the most important thing to you, could that make a difference in some years? Absolutely. In others, it may not. Mm-hmm. But there are other ways that you might address the late budget problem. I just wanted to add that.
No, and I appreciate your adding that. And unfortunately, my choices are not available in terms of some of the ideas that you talk about that are the perfect. And in my statement, I started out saying that the good cannot be the enemy of the perfect. The only problem I have when we make these discussions is that whenever an idea comes on the table, then we find these other alternatives that are perfect. I wish a more perfect document and proposal and proposition were before us, but in fact it is not. I have but one choice, and my question is, on behalf of my constituents who have child care centers and are not getting paid, some of whom have are vendors and are having to use their personal credit cards to pay staff, and obviously they are not getting paid. On their behalf, is this initiative going to be one that moves us closer to resolving a budget and submitting a budget on time? And you ask the question, is resolving a budget on time my goal? Absolutely, beyond a shadow of a doubt. And I wish those others with perfect ideas about what we ought to be doing had a proposition before us that we could be discussing today. I'm stuck. I'm stuck in reality about what's on the table today. My questions and the reason why I'm here is about what's on the table today. On the table today is Prop 25. Will Prop 25 help the constituents in California to move closer, potentially? I think that perhaps, based upon what I've heard, it will. Now, we have to do the work in terms of the election of the next governor, because this bill doesn't deal with that. But in terms of focusing, as the Chairman Blumenfield has asked us to do, I strongly believe, based upon what I've heard you and others say, and not just your comments to me, but what I've heard you say throughout the duration of my attendance here, I believe that Prop 25 will move this institution closer to what the voters, those who sent me here, want to see happen.
Thank you very much, Mr. Davis. Mr. Desaulniers, followed by Ms. Buchanan.
Just, I had a couple of questions, and I can only imagine how hard it is to defend the status quo, Mr. Wolf and company. But I do have a question in that regard. So you're advocating a no vote because you believe the current situation vis-a-vis a majority vote to pass the budget is good fiscal policy. Is that accurate? Just in this context, following the directions of the chair.
Senator, we believe it is prudent that the state live within its means. California this year is slated to bring in $85 billion worth of revenue, still more revenue than any other state in the union. We believe a two-thirds vote budget helps ensure that the spending priorities that are important to the state are dealt with.
Now, having said that, Mr. Wolf, you and my respect for you, and we have differences of opinion, but the two places where our budget has grown exponentially is the Department of Corrections and debt service. We have the worst credit rating of any state, or tied with Alabama, thank God for Alabama, for credit. So, and the LAO can contribute here if they would, but there's a contradiction here, I think, that the general public thinks the supermajority, and I think you're defending this position, is that the supermajority is good fiscal policy, that it keeps Democrats, in this instance, from spending too much money. The evidence contradicts that, at least as in terms of the three rating agencies who have all mentioned that our inability to pass a budget on time would indicate to them that we should actually pay more for indebtedness. So how do you reconcile those two opposing factors, given that I know you have great respect for the rating agencies?
Senator, debt service is a very serious issue. Between general obligation bond debt and unfunded pension liabilities, we're looking at least 15% of our general fund going to these two categories by the year 2014. It's a very, very serious issue. And there are programs such as corrections and higher education where there are not mandated streams of revenue flowing into those programs that are going to be negatively impacted. And that's sad, but all the more reason why we need to prioritize our revenue. And coming back to Prop 25, prioritizing our revenue by allowing this body to, again, in our view, pass tax increases with a majority vote does not prioritize that revenue stream.
Mr. Wolf, I'm disappointed. Now, we're just talking about this initiative, and we can argue about, but the courts have said it doesn't give us the ability, and the LAO has opined that it doesn't give us the ability to raise taxes. So just indulge me for a second. Assume that it doesn't. In this instance, by keeping the supermajority, it actually continues to add to our debt service, does it not? At least according to the rating agencies. So it's not good fiscal policy according to the three rating agencies. Can you reconcile that? Just that question. Thank you. No more questions.
Yeah. Senator, I'll answer it. I'm here to speak on the proposition, and I'm here to speak on our viewing and what we believe the measure to entail. And we believe that the measure, and it says it in the measure, states quite clearly that that the budget bill or appropriations related to the budget bill requires a majority vote.
I don't want to go around and around in the circle. I mean, you had a specific question. Right. You can answer it, but just I don't want to keep repeating the
it wasn't related what's in to the our measure, ability or inability to raise taxes. It was whether this would affect our credit rating in any kind of positive way by passing this.
Just the
ability to pass the budget.
I can't turn away from what the measure says. The measure is far broader than just the budget.
I'm just asking you a simple question, Mr. Wolf. If, let's imagine, we're in a world where the courts continue to opine, as Mr. Olson has said, that we're not raising, let's just a hypothetical that's not much of a hypothetical in my mind because the appellate court has already said this. So if all it is to pass a budget, and the credit agencies have said this is a problem and leads to larger interest on our indebtedness, isn't that bad fiscal policy? And it just seems to me that you're not answering the question with all due respect.
I'll take another stab at answering the question. The reason our credit rating is shoddy is because we're not passing a budget on time and because
exactly.
We're not prioritizing our revenue.
Thank you.
But doing it on a majority vote is not the appropriate way to do it.
Okay, thank you. Ms. Buchanan.
I'll try and be brief as well. Mr. Wolf, we have the legislative analyst, Mac Taylor, who has said this retains the same two-thirds vote for taxes. We have the counsel for the yes on 25 saying it retains it. We have a Sacramento Superior Court judge's decision saying it retains the same provision to raise taxes. We have the Third Circuit Court of Appeals say that it retains that provision. Do you have a legal opinion you can give us that refutes that?
Ms. Buchanan, the Superior Court actually ruled in favor of us. So, I mean, that is an opinion and a vote I can give you.
No, the Superior Court did not rule in favor of you. If you read the opinion, and you can certainly correct me, Mr. Olson, if you want, if I read the news articles incorrectly, the Superior Court decision agreed that the proposition did not allow taxes to be raised with a simple majority vote. What it said was that they thought the ballot argument would confuse voters into voting yes. In other words, making people believe they had to vote yes to retain the two-thirds vote. It did not agree that indeed it would change that requirement. The Court of Appeal went on to say no, it's not confusing, and said that you could not raise, it did not change the current provision. So I want to know if you have any kind of legal opinion that supports your statement that you can raise tax, that this will allow you to raise taxes with a simple majority vote. I mean, because ultimately this is all decided in a court of law, correct?
Madam Assemblymember, if I could opine for a moment on that. I think what it is there's still seems to be a lot of ambiguity. You know, from our perspective, from the business community, there are a number of instances in the legislature where there have been attempts, regardless of what Constitution says or legal opinion has stated, that we go forward. This year, as far as what conference report has looked at and adopted either in current version or earlier, we have two examples of that. The Quill decision, which deals with interstate commerce and use tax on Nexus, clearly states there's a fine line as to where you can and cannot collect sales tax.
The Quill decision has nothing to do with whether it's a two-thirds vote, correct?
No.
So I'd like it to be.
Absolutely. Okay. But yet there is legislation in the current budget proposal that would go against that constitutional report.
That legislation wouldn't change whether you had a two-thirds vote for the budget or a simple majority vote because it has. So I think we need to stick to that actual.
But I thank you. I guess what I'm trying to get at on that is because of the current ambiguity with the court system in this particular situation, the Prop 25, and whether or not it can increase taxes or not, there is concern among the business community and perspective, I'm not necessarily speaking for Mr. Wolf, that given past history of this legislature saying, forget the Constitution, what is the assurance that we wouldn't say that again next year, the year after, should Prop 25 pass?
Isn't that a false argument, though, because that has nothing to do with anything in this proposition that changes the requirement?
Well, actually, I think you have to look at a very holistic approach anytime you approach legislation or propositions, initiatives, referendums, whatnot. Looking at, okay, sure, does that spell exactly what happens November 2nd if Prop 25 passed? You've got me, absolutely. But what are the long-term ramifications of that passage? We can't look at it in a box. We have to look at what are the what-ifs. We had a hypothetical conversation by Mr. Davis a little earlier. Mr. Fuhrer asked a question and actually opined that this is there are long-term impacts to constitutional
initiatives. I just think we need to be intellectually honest with the voters. And there's absolutely nothing in this proposition that would, whether it passes or fails, that would preclude us from potentially having those discussions a year, 5 years, 10 years down the road. So I think it's critically important to do that. Just as I was listening to the commercial coming up here, the implication that somehow legislators are buying $100 bottles of wine on the taxpayer dollar and will be able to buy even more expensive wine if this passes. I mean, I think it's important for people to make decisions based on what the actual information is. I have another question for you, Mr. Wolf. One of your arguments was that 16 states of those who have simple majority votes failed to pass a budget on time. You know, you can look at that either way, because 47 states can pass budgets with simple majority votes, which means that 31 could, and I actually think most people in California would love those kind of odds to have an on-time budget, even 2 out of 3 years with us. But of those 16 states, how many of them had budgets that were 80 or 85 days late? How late were they, and how often did those states not pass budgets on time?
Ms. Buchanan, to be honest, I don't have that information here in front of me. My only point in bringing that up was to say that the majority vote budget is not necessarily a cure-all to fix all of the state's woes.
And I think everyone here agrees that it's not necessarily a cure-all. When you have a financial times like we're having now, where state revenues have declined 20% 2 years in a row, which is unprecedented in modern times, certainly it's going to be difficult. And it's not to argue that we wouldn't have to have a two-thirds budget, because if you had to raise revenue, everyone agrees here that you'd have to have that two-thirds vote. The question is if we have a simple majority vote, is it a greater likelihood that we will be able to pass a budget on time, or that we will have these 70, 80, 85, potentially we could end up with 90-day delays? Do you have any opinion on that, or not?
I agree with what Mr. Taylor said earlier. I don't think you can handicap that process. It's going to differ from state to state. And again, there's no guarantee with a majority vote budget that it will be passed on time. That was the only point I was trying to make.
See, what I see is that Democrats now are in the majority, so, you know, Republicans don't want to see Democrats pass a budget with a majority vote. There was a time, you know, a decade ago when Republicans were in the majority, and I'm sure if that were the case, you'd have Democrats arguing against it, but someone has to be held accountable. And I've only been in the Assembly now for 2 years, but I will tell you that when you attach legislation to the budget that has nothing to do with the budget, it isn't usually well written. And the people who even write it, you know, who are negotiating the deals, oftentimes don't know what's in it. And I saw over this last 2 years, whether it was the budget or the water legislation or corrections or Race to the Top, we had to come back and make changes to all of them because it was legislation that was written in the 11th hour of the night, and it's not the way to write good policy. So one of the things that I believe will happen with a simple majority budget bill is we will hopefully have a bill, regardless of which party's in control, that will be a budget bill and that won't have all these other bills attached to it. Beyond that, Assemblymember Harkey and I actually worked together quite a bit on looking at the state finances, and we're probably in 90% agreement, much more agreement than disagreement in terms of the dire financial condition of the state, and we don't agree on all the reforms, but we do believe there are significant reforms that need to happen. And I think, you know, when she talks about the people's priority in the state, education, transportation, public safety, water, they're right on. That's what their priorities are. But I think we need to take a look at what happens to those areas when we don't pass a budget on time. Because I have people that come into my office who are with the Associated General Contractors, many of whom are hanging on by their fingernails just to stay in business. And they say, I don't care what you have to do, just get a budget passed on time. Because if I can't get paid, I'm not going to be in business. And when I drive down 680, which is the main road going through Central Contra Costa, which is in horrible shape. We're probably all having our cars thrown out of alignment and everything else. The reason they're not starting that project is because this budget is delayed. We have 12.4% unemployment. We have 30% unemployment with construction workers. We're not putting these people back to work or allowing these firms to stay in business when we don't pass a budget on time. I have more than 12 school districts in my assembly district. They still have open positions because they don't know how much money they're going to have. And that's not fair to the teachers who have been laid off, many of whom have gotten pink slips year after year. Every school district in my assembly district was giving pink slips to teachers who have been there for 5 or 6 years. We're losing a generation of teachers, not to mention the impact that our fiscal problems are having on schools themselves. So if we passed a budget on time, the school districts would know how much money they'd have, and they'd be able to employ teachers instead of having us pay them unemployment. And then when I take a look at the vendors, my office gets called all the time from small businesses who are doing business with the state who aren't getting paid, who don't know how they're going to stay in business, and they're also employing people, and they need to make payroll. So when I take a look at how a late budget impacts our public safety, with our cities not knowing what they're getting, but when I take a look at how a late budget impacts business, because I don't think there's anything more important right now than creating jobs, putting people back to work, and getting this economy going, we're not doing that when it takes us 3 months to work out a budget deal. And that's the problem that I have with the current budgeting process. Now, is a simple majority vote going to solve all of that? No. I tell you, there's a part of me as a Democrat, it kind of scares me because I'm going to have to go to my allies and say, you know what, we have to make these cuts because we have to pass a budget on time. You know, right now I can blame it on the Republicans and the 3 votes we need in the Assembly. But I don't think we're really doing the people's work right now. And I think they're frustrated. I was at a presentation last night speaking about it, and they want it to work. And passing a budget five times out of 30 years just should not be acceptable to anyone. So I don't know if this is the perfect solution, but I think it greatly increases our probability of passing a budget on time. And I just have one final comment to make. We have to stop blaming education for our budget problems. We have the greatest discrepancy in how we fund our schools and the national average that we've had in 40 years. We're near the bottom, and we want excellence in our schools. It's just not going to happen. So, the, you know, any implications that, you know, our budget problems are caused because we have to fund education is just, it's insulting to me, and it should be insulting to the children and the parents in this state, because not having a quality education system, and we have cut $9 billion from education, is going to have tremendous long-term implications on our ability to bring businesses to California and have a strong economy.
Thank you, Ms. Buchanan. Mr. Hoffman.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This discussion today underscores for me the critical difference between politics and policy. Politics was the radio ads we all heard when we drove in today, where people are out there opposing Prop 25 by prevaricating about what's in it and what it does, by saying that it will raise your taxes. Policy is what we're supposed to do in an official session of this legislative body here under the dome, and it's supposed to be very, very different than the stuff that passes for politics on our radio airwaves. And I'm very disturbed today that too much of that politics has invaded what ought to be a higher standard in our legislative process. And two things have been said in particular that trouble me today by the opponents of Prop 25. The first is that it was said that Prop 25 could have included language that said it wouldn't raise taxes but didn't. Well, nobody's read it to you yet, but let me just read the exact language that is in the proposition. It says this measure will not change Prop 13's property tax limitations in any way. This measure will not change the two-thirds vote requirement for the legislature to raise taxes. It's in there. I read it. What was said was demonstrably false and I think unbecoming of what ought to pass in a proceeding in this dome. The second thing that troubles me is the repeated statement that somehow there is ambiguity, legal ambiguity, about whether Prop 25 raises taxes, because we had a superior court decision that was later overturned by an appellate court decision. Well, I know not everybody's a lawyer here, but I gotta tell you that statement is extremely disingenuous. It's like saying there is ambiguity about who won the World Series because the team that ultimately won was behind in the first inning. It doesn't work that way, folks. The appellate court bats last, and the law on this issue is settled. Prop 25 doesn't raise your taxes. Prop 25 does not change the vote threshold for raising your taxes. And if you don't believe the settled law as it's been handed to us by the courts, our independent legislative analyst sat here and confirmed it today. So when it comes to the policy of what's actually in Prop 25, what we're supposed to be talking about and understanding here in this proceeding today, there's no ambiguity. We know what Prop 25 is. I've just read to you the measure's provision when it comes to taxes, and you've heard from the legislative analyst, and the state of the law has been explained to us. I know that when we leave this proceeding, we're going to go back to the politics of all this, and unfortunately, it seems that anything goes these days when it comes to the politics, but let's have a little higher standard here in an official legislative proceeding.
Thank you, Mr. Hoffman. Final comment, Mr. Swanson.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I'm not as familiar with Mr. Hines as I am with Mr. Wolfen. I have a lot of respect for Mr. Wolfen, particularly his work ethic. I really hope that this message is getting through, and that is that it is good for California business. For us to have a budget on time. It costs the taxpayers of the state money when we delay. Nothing good happens. And I, you know, frankly, I was hopeful that Howard Jarvis would look closer at this measure, because I see it, you know, this whole issue, the objective of the measure was to, through good government, and move this process forward. And everyone knew that it didn't answer all the questions. It was clear about that. But the question of whether or not taxes can be raised through this measure has been already won in the court. The court has been clear about that. And so that's not on the table. It can't happen under this initiative. That doesn't have to be litigated any further. And if someone tried to do it under this measure, settled law would address that question. And so I'm hopeful that this hearing will put a spotlight on this measure in a way that business interests will look at it carefully to determine whether or not they're better served with a budget on time, those that are interested in our schools, those that are interested in child care centers not being closed, or us going up and down with furlough decisions which close state services. And so I'm hopeful that this hearing has spotlighted that the issue before us is a question of accountability, stopping the gridlock for the budget process, and allowing us to hold the legislature accountable, to pass a budget on time, to increase our bond rating, to allow for there to be some predictability in how we approach these questions. But it's not, I think this is not a anti-business or something that will hurt the taxpayers. I think it's more along the lines of responsibility, and I just wanted to offer that to both of you, John.
Mr. Chair, would you mind me responding just briefly to that?
Very, very, 30 seconds.
Okay. I would like to once again say that we greatly appreciate the opportunity to be here to present. Mr. Swanson, Ms. Buchanan, we wholeheartedly agree with you that nobody benefits from these delayed, continuous budget delays. I think where the disagreement is what the solution is. I think there's been much discussion about the initiative process being broken. We would much prefer to be working with you all than trying to work through another broken system that continues to exacerbate the ongoing budget problems that we've had. So with that, again, thank you. To disagree on how to get there.
Thank you very much. I'm eager to get to the cash portion of this, but before we do, it's necessary, I want to open it up. Is there any public testimony on this issue? If there is, please go to the mic. Seeing one, please state your name and your position.
Good afternoon. My name's Ashley Martinez, and I'm here on behalf of SEIU Local 1000. And I just want to quickly mention that we do support Proposition 25. Our members have experienced what the supermajority vote requirement does and the harm that it can create across California. Just three things just to note. One, furloughs. Furloughs have been detrimental not only to our members, but also as citizens in California and their ability to purchase from small businesses. And also to provide vital services to Californians. Secondly, the threat, and it did not happen, but the threat of minimum wage, which would have cost over $1 billion in revenue in California every single month because a budget wasn't passed, and we were threatened with minimum wage. And thirdly, we have experienced it, and it has caused tremendous hardship across California, and that's why we support it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Seeing no further testimony, I want to thank the witnesses and the members for participating in this very lengthy discussion about Prop 25. I don't think we resolved anything in terms of we did get to answer a lot of questions and discussions, and we certainly, I think, we can all agree that we fulfilled our obligation under California Election Code Section 9034 in terms of having an exhaustive hearing on this. And with that, I'd like to excuse the witnesses. Thank you very much. And begin the second part of our hearing, which is equally as important, although probably will be shorter in length, I do hope. While the witnesses for that are coming to the dais, I just want to, or to the podium, want to set the stage a little bit. Thank everybody who is remaining with us through this process, and please come forward as I'm speaking. So what we're going to do here is we're going to hear an update from the State Comptroller's Office regarding California's cash position. What I want to do first, though, is really thank Comptroller Chung and his office for doing a great job over the last few months keeping California government functioning. The Comptroller's Office has a critical role in helping us fix our fiscal woes and is often overlooked, but they really do yeoman's work, and it's important to recognize that. With the latest budget in state history compounding the state's perilous cash position, our controller has been in the center of trying to find the solutions to keep this state moving, and I want to recognize the capable and professional job of that office, and particularly the controller, John Chung. from issuing IOUs, dealing with the PMIB, the funding shortfall in 08, and withholding payments due to last year's late budget, the Comptroller's Office has continued to be the bearer of bad news. But he's also brought us some solutions. We're not issuing IOUs today because the Comptroller's Office championed a cash deferral bill, which we adopted earlier this year. And I want to thank them for handling the difficult problems with foresight and compassion and even-handedness. Today they're going to provide a picture of our cash position. I remember reading the August cash report earlier this month, and it reminded me of the urgency we face in trying to get this budget passed. I don't want to see IOUs passed our critical infrastructure projects. I don't want to see them held up again like in previous years. And now that the governor has returned from Asia, I hope that the leadership discussions in Los Angeles today will yield the overall compromise that we need to get this budget passed. My conversations with the speaker recently indicate that there has been some measurable progress in the last couple of days since the governor's return from abroad. So that's all very positive. Today we have two speakers, the Comptroller's Office, John Hyber, Chief of Operations, and Jim Lombard, the Chief Administrative Officer. Whoever among you wants to begin, please identify yourself and begin. Thank you.
Sure. John Hyber, State Comptroller's Office. Mr. Chairman and members, thank you for the opportunity to speak today. This afternoon, I will provide a brief summary of cash flow. First, I'll talk about what happened in September and then discuss the process of that we go through in our office of determining the need to issue registered warrants. And then I'll talk about a couple cash flow pressures that we would face if when we do have enactment of the budget. The first thing I'd like to note is we would have started issuing registered warrants many months ago if it were not for three things. The fact that we have $20 billion in internal resources available to us, borrowable funds. Secondly, the cash flow deferrals that were approved in the spring, $4 to $5 billion, and then the amount that we're not currently paying because we don't have a budget. The fact that we don't have a cash balance right now, a positive cash balance, really is almost a mirage. It's not a sign right now that we're on solid ground. First, what happened in September? The State Comptroller's Office does monitor cash flow on a daily basis. Our office was preparing to issue registered warrants in September. We prepared to begin issuing registered warrants that at the time it becomes necessary. We're ready to go any day right now, and it's based upon our cash flow analysis that we conduct on a daily basis. Based on earlier estimates, it showed that we would be below the $2.5 billion cushion that we try to keep at any given time. We would be below that cushion on the third week of September and or of October, I'm sorry, and then drop into the red the last week of October. So August turned out to be positive. Revenues were about $265 million positive. Expenditures were lower than what we had anticipated, and borrowables remained strong. So in summary, because receipts, expenditures, and borrowables all stayed very positive in September, they were better than what we had estimated at May revision, we were able to avoid the issuance of registered warrants for the time being. So to the question, when will the State Comptroller's Office look at issuing registered warrants? The controller is using all his powers to avoid the issuance of registered warrants. The tools that we have available to us for cash management are internal borrowing, legislatively approved deferrals. We look at external borrowing through ARAN and to defer payments. Our office recognizes the issuance of registered warrants would likely trigger a ratings downgrade. But the question really isn't whether there would be a downgrade. The question would be how many downgrades would we see if we were to issue registered warrants. And we need to keep in mind that the time to issue registered warrants is not when we run out of cash. We predict out on the horizon a point at which we would drop below our $2.5 billion cushion. So we need to preserve our ability to make priority payments, which includes education and debt service. So at the point where we determine we're below our $2.5 billion cushion, we need to back up from that date so we can continue to make our priority payments. Last summer the state had an approved budget, and it was necessary to issue registered warrants. What we're looking at right now is there is no budget, and as a result, we're not making many payments to vendors, to local governments and to providers. Through the end of September, there will be almost $6 billion in payments that have not occurred since we don't have a budget, and therefore we don't have the authority to make those payments. So the goal of our office is to keep a cash cushion of at least $2.5 billion in cash. In the last year, we've seen wild swings. It's very volatile in revenues, expenditures, and borrowables. And because of this volatility, we can see swings of $1 billion a day. For example, I just looked at today's cash flow. In the last couple days in expenditures, we see volatility of just about $1 billion on expenditures, different from what we had estimated. Currently, we estimate that the cash balance will drop in October. Even with the positive cash report from August, it will be below $2.5 billion and will be at $1.1 billion the last week of the month. As a result, we're still looking at the possibility of issuing registered warrants in October. The timing will be determined by where we are in terms of the $2.5 billion cushion and the status of revenues, expenditures, and borrowables. To the extent that revenues, expenditures, and borrowables go up or down, that determines the date at which registered warrants would need to be necessary. Now, I passed out a chart before I started to speak, and I'd like to address that chart. To address the question of if a budget is approved soon, what will happen? Now, if you look at the first page of that chart, what this chart represents is where we are on a cash basis if we have to pay all the pent-up demand in the no-pays as a result of the lack of budget right now. At the end of October, we'll be $7.2 billion negative, and if you were to factor in our cash cushion, that means that we would need $9.7 billion to stay positive, to stay cash positive. Now, keep in mind, this does not factor in any solutions. This is on a cash basis right now using our current estimates. So to the extent that there are solutions either on the expenditure side or on the revenue side, that would minimize this amount. But if there's an expectation that a budget will allow us to pay pent-up payments immediately, that's really not realistic. There will be a period, we believe, where payments will need to be delayed until cash flow borrowing can be completed by the State Treasurer's Office. We're working with the Department of Finance and the State Treasurer's Office to identify alternatives so that it'll be possible to maintain cash flow after the budget is signed. And what can the legislature do? With a budget, it's important to be honest and straightforward with budget solutions. This will allow us to borrow less and to borrow more quickly. To the extent that the budget would include gimmicks and unreliable solutions, investors will cast a critical eye, and those factors will be discounted. Unrealistic budget assumptions will make it harder to borrow, it'll take more time, and it will cost more. Finally, it's important to set expectations at a realistic level, as we believe it would be a tragedy, even if there is a budget approved, that it would be necessary to issue registered warrants. And both Mr. Lombard and I are available to answer any questions at this time.
Yeah, Jim Lombard, Chief Administrative Officer for the State Controller's Office. I'm here to talk about the no pays, if you'd like me to go over that now, or if you'd like to ask John some questions now.
You make your presentation, then we'll ask you both questions.
So I passed out, there's another handout you have, it's information off of our website about the no pays. Essentially, the no pays under a no budget situation are defined by a litigation, White v. Davis, and that lawsuit identified that we were authorized to make payments when there was a continuing appropriation, when there's expenditures that were charged to a prior year, so any payments that were due as a result of goods or services provided in a prior year, when the payment is authorized by the Constitution, and then when the payment is required by federal law. So in that regard, there's a number of issues that are identified in here of where we make payment and where we don't. Essentially, for Vendors, we do not pay vendors in the current year for any claims. We do, however, pay prior year claims for vendors. For schools, largely we make the revenue payments. Categorical funding we do not pay. That requires a Budget Act appropriation. Payroll is governed by the Fair Labor Standards Act, which is a federal provision. Anybody that's covered under that act will be paid. That issue's, of course, in litigation at this point. And there's a number of other federal payments that we make, CalWORK Stage 1 in IHSS and some other social service programs. So in a nutshell, we're governed by White v. Davis. We can make continuously appropriations, prior year payments, and constitutional payments, and those payments required by the federal government. So.
Okay. I should have given Mr. Nielsen a chance at the beginning, so I'm going to have you start with questions and whatever comments you'd like to make.
Just quickly, go over again as far as the completion of a budget, the signing of the budget, and then the delaying of being able to go out and achieve the RANs. What's the lag time there? So, in other words, how much longer additional delay beyond that occasion will vendors be suffering a bit?
We believe that we would work with the Treasurer's Office to obtain an interim RAN, and that we believe will take 3 to 4 weeks. It'll take us a couple weeks to work with finance to identify the cash flows, and then it'll take the Treasurer's Office a couple weeks to do the borrowing. It's not clear to me at this time. Once we do our cash flows, we'll have a better understanding of the size of the interim RAN and what can be supported. It takes us about, again, a couple weeks to get the cash flows done, and then it takes to obtain the full RAN that we'll need approximately 4 more weeks, so that'll be about 6 weeks. So we'll need some significant cash solutions during that period of time, so we're not issuing IOUs immediately after the budget's signed. We're working with the Department of Finance and the Treasurer's Office at this time to look at some solutions that we could potentially bring forward for you guys to consider.
And would those require statutory action or just administrative?
We believe it'd be statutory.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Hoppe.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This is a very helpful document, and I'm just wondering, since it's dated August 2010, if you have any way of providing us with the ongoing information for September or even projecting out further how that might change.
Yeah, we do. It's on our website.
This was the latest. As I understand it, the can be paid and cannot be paid are all for August of 2010.
Yeah, that's can I get back to you on that issue? We believe we have that available, and we apologize for giving you the August information.
Terrific, because it's a very helpful format, and I think we'd like to be on top of what the latest numbers are. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Dasanya, Senator.
Just had a specific question asked to transportation. Is transportation going to continue to be allowed to be funded for lots of rumors about Caltrans actually stopping projects in the very near future? Or from your perspective, is it on the same trajectory as everything else?
Well, I would answer that question by saying right now we don't have a budget, and the reason that Caltrans is proposing to suspend those projects is because there's no budget. To the extent we do get a budget, they would be able to move forward with those projects.
Absent a budget, would we be looking about a week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks?
Well, it's difficult to say right now. It depends on when we would get a budget. It's now the last week of September.
Yeah, let's assume the worst and say we don't get a budget the next month. Will Caltrans have to suspend the projects, in your opinion?
I'd be reluctant to speak for Caltrans. Okay. I'd be hard-pressed to think of a way that things could continue.
Appreciate that.
Another issue that could jeopardize those projects is the ability for the Treasurer's Office to sell bonds. We understand that there's some pressure, and there's a blackout period in, I believe it's in the end of November or first part of November. Anyway, we're coming close to the time where it jeopardizes their ability to sell GO bonds, and that may impact those projects as well.
Now, this month, revenues have been up a certain amount, right? $900 million or so. Is that, if it keeps at that trajectory, I mean, can we survive past October?
Right. I saw the same email earlier today. And that's certainly good news. It suggested that revenues were up for the month, I believe, something like $900 million, excuse me, which is good news. However, earlier in my presentation, I described the volatility. Interestingly enough, 2 days later, those same revenues were down to about $500 million. So that identifies the volatility of the issue, and that's it could be a timing issue, and they could be permanent. There's also the issue of it might be that individuals are paying their taxes early when they could otherwise wait until December. So if that's the case, maybe we're getting this revenue early, which is still a good thing, but that's revenue that we may not see in December. So there are a few unknowns about this revenue surge. Nonetheless, it's still good, but we need to figure out why it's here.
And also, I imagine since we've made a lot of changes in the last couple of years, it's probably harder to have direct comparables for what our revenue should be and shouldn't be. Whereas, you know, 5 years ago, probably it was much more of a science. Now, I don't know, I mean, maybe you could tell us a little bit about that process. I mean, how do you even go about determining what is the expected revenue given that we've changed the timing of when revenue comes in? We've dramatically changed that process.
I think it's more of an art now. We've worked closely with Department of Finance and the Treasurer's Office. We have to redo the cash flows every year. We're not following the same revenues. We've moved expenditures out. We've deferred expenditures. The cash deferral bill has delayed some of the expenditures. It's moving all over the place. We're just not following the same trends that we used to follow. So again, we work very closely with Department of Finance and the Treasurer's Office to develop the cash flows that we're working on.
So what you had mentioned in response to Mr. Nielsen's comment about how we would, if we get a budget passed, there's going to be certain things potentially statutory that we'll have to do so that we still don't end up in that problem where we, you know, we're all overjoyed, we get a budget, and then a week later we're issuing warrants and our credit rating, as you said, doesn't just downgrade once, it downgrades multiple times. Help me understand and us understand, what are those kinds of things that we may have to do, and are any of those things that we should be sort of starting now or preparing now to do?
Well, the first part that I would address is the fact that whatever budget agreement there is, I would suspect that there are some both expenditure solutions and other solutions contained in that agreement. And so we'd have to see how those shake out in terms of cash flow. But we don't know that right now. We'd have to take a look at that. From our perspective here at the controller's office.
Just be clear what you're referring to. I mean, obviously there's going to be dramatic cuts in the budget.
Right.
Even all the budgets that we put forward had some dramatic cuts in it. So right. Are you assuming, is that what you're referring to by? Well,
right now I'm not assuming anything. I'm just, I'm anticipating that there would be some solutions contained in that budget. So we'd have to see on a cash flow basis how that would shake out, where they would fall during the remainder of the year and how much they would be. Already we're in September. I can't imagine that it would be possible to catch very much that has occurred in the past 3 months. Most of it would have to be on a prospective basis. So that would be the first thing that I would look at. Secondly, what I'd want to look at is if there's the possibility of any other sort of deferrals that we could take a look at. It's difficult right now. I'm not sure how that would shake out. So we'd have to look at different deferrals that might be possible. That might be contained in some of the solutions in the budget. The third component I would take a look at, and we've already been working with the State Treasurer's Office on this and with the Department of Finance, Mr. Lombard mentioned this earlier, is the fact that we're already trying to build the foundation so when it comes time for an interim RAN, that we can address that issue as promptly as possible and then establish the permanent RAN when we can. So that's how we would approach the situation should there be a budget agreement, so we can pull everything together as quickly as possible. And the potential would be there, it might still be necessary to defer some payments. But until we get more information, it's very difficult to put numbers together and give any shape to it.
Any additional member comments? Mr. Gatto.
So, you know, every once in a while you read in the newspaper where an enterprising journalist has taken the time to estimate how much in terms of real dollars that the delay costs Californians. I actually like this because it helps us when we go back to our districts really explain the cost to the state for delays in terms of every factor. There's our cost to our credit rating. There's a cost in terms of borrowing costs. Do you guys feel comfortable given an estimate of shorthand that we can say what every day costs the state in terms of delays, figuring in all the factors, both the borrowing costs, the potential damage to our credit rating, et cetera?
We don't have an estimate on that number now. It'd be a pretty comprehensive number. I'd be willing to work with you to try to come up with something, but I know that in the past, I can't remember what they are offhand. There are increased borrowing costs. There are costs related to the late payment of invoices for things in the past year that still need an appropriation where none exists. So there's a menu of items that include costs, and undoubtedly there would be greater costs as a result of a delayed budget, and those would be on our side. On the side of the vendors and other individuals who are not receiving payment, there's a great cost there as well.
And of course, doesn't even begin to quantify the human cost in terms of, you know, the child care providers, adult day health care providers, and the constituencies that they serve.
And that's a very good point. And if I could also volunteer that in my position as the chief operating officer at the state controller's office, I probably get at least 3 to 4 calls daily, and that's a low number on a daily basis. And I know throughout our office we get more, where I get calls from CalWORKs providers or charter schools or other entities who are facing, child care centers primarily, who are facing closure because they don't have the funds to continue, and they're looking at closing the doors, and they're coming to us to see if there's anything that we can do to help.
Appreciate that. Seeing no additional member question or comments, is there any comments from the public? Okay. Well, then, seeing none, I want to thank you very much for, I know you guys sat through the entire Prop 25 hearing, which I know is scintillating for you, but to come and...
I was confident that ours would be shorter.
Yes, and you were correct. And thank you, members, for participating in this hearing, and hopefully we will all move forward and have a budget, a good budget, mm-hmm. soon. Thank you. This hearing is over.